Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be talking about search for extraterrestrial intelligence. And, well, you might be aware that we've been looking for so-called aliens, or specifically technologically advanced aliens, for quite a long time now. The so-called SETI at Home program, for example, has been around for close to about 20 years now. And, well, you've probably also heard that we haven't really found anything yet. In this video, though, we're going to specifically discuss one major project that discovered, nothing. There seems to be no one trying to talk to us in the vicinity. And I really wanted to start with this. This actually is the beautiful image that represents the so-called extent of human radio broadcasts. In other words, it shows you, in galactic terms, how far we've been able to communicate from the time we started communicating with the world. In other words, this shows you hypothetically how far the first ever signal from planet Earth was able to travel across the galaxy. And here, by looking at our galaxy and zooming in a little bit, you'll notice that there's a little blue dot right there. And this blue dot represents roughly around 200 light years in diameter of radio communication since the beginning of radio communication on Earth. In other words, it shows us how far the radio waves were able to travel across the galaxy, and as you can see, it's practically nothing. Now, there's another really brilliant simulation that I've talked about a few years ago that I wanted to show you, but for this one, I can't really use sound because I'm going to get a copyright claim, because it actually has a lot of popular songs. This simulation is called Lightyear.fm, and it literally takes you distance-wise from basically today, whatever the popular songs are today, up to approximately early 1900s with some of the older songs out there. And this is actually a brilliant visual simulation of radio signals traveling across the galaxy. Here we can actually advance a little bit just to see how things change very dramatically, and you start moving across various star systems, nebula, and a lot of other areas up to right here. And so this is the farthest distance of radio communication since we started sending signals out there. And this kind of takes us to this topic of, well, searching for extraterrestrial intelligence, because that's kind of what we think the technologically advanced aliens might be doing too. Maybe they're blasting music. Maybe they're sending signals to each other, trying to communicate with other planets, or maybe they're just basically sending signals to other aliens that might be out there, because we've actually done that as well. And so we're listening and we're trying to discover something, anything. And the biggest project to date is, of course, search for extraterrestrial intelligence connected to the Berkeley SETI at Home that I actually ran for a few years myself, which is basically like the simulation you run on your computer that uses data from these telescopes and then crunches the numbers and tries to find anything. But the biggest modern project is actually this right here. This is Project Breakthrough Listen that has been sponsored and was able to raise up to about $100 million on this specific task, finding aliens. And the amount of telescope time that was awarded to this project over the years is actually kind of mind-blowing. We've literally been able to listen and also look at the skies from various different perspectives, various different frequencies for a very long time now. This project has actually been very active in the last few years and has been consecutively every 6 months releasing the data that's publicly available for everyone to look at and to see if they discover anything there. But as I mentioned in the beginning, so far nothing. What is this project though? Well, it's actually kind of connected to the famous Breakthrough Starshot project that I'm sure you've heard of by now, where we're basically planning to use these really powerful lasers to propel these tiny spacecraft to the nearby Alpha Centauri, actually Proxima Centauri system, where we're hoping to investigate what's going on there and find out if there's any life there. But this is kind of far from being realized. So while this project is still being planned, Project Breakthrough Listen has been actively going on for a few years now. And it actually reached a point where we can now easily hear a typical aircraft radar or something similar to an aircraft radar from anywhere within about 160 or so light years away from us, or from approximately 1,000 nearby stars. So if there's an aircraft somewhere out there and it's using a radar and it accidentally points at Earth, we'll be able to actually hear it. At the same time, another telescope that's able to see visual light is actively looking for any kind of laser emissions. The Lick Observatory that you see on the screen right here is actually able to detect lasers that are approximately 100 watt or so from as far as 5 light years away, and if it's something even more powerful, it will see it from farther away. So our telescopes have advanced to the point where we can actually very accurately see things. And the eventual goal of this project is to analyze nearby million or so stars and also very loud 100 or so galaxies where we can easily see things and also hear things. And the idea here is to try to discover something somewhere, specifically using things like, for example, the what we call quiet zone, or where it's the frequency between about 1 to 10 gigahertz, and it's usually not affected by anything here on Earth, so we can easily see it in space. In other words, we're looking for various radio frequencies which we think might be used by alien species to communicate. And although Project Breakthrough Listen only started in January of 2016, we expect it to go on for at least 10 years, possibly even longer, and we're going to be actively looking at every single possible destination. And by the way, it's already looked at some of the more common sort of targets, including Oumuamua, which is the unusual interstellar visitor that we had last year, and some of the objects like the famous Tabby star that we expected may potentially have a megastructure around it, but over the years we realized that it was most likely comets that were causing these unusual dimming effects. Nevertheless, though, this project actually listened very actively to this region, but once again discovered nothing. And by the way, if you'd like to read the paper about Tabby star, also known as Boyajian star, it's right here on the screen and also in the description below. It does provide more data and more analysis on how they determine that there's probably no actual aliens trying to communicate with us from there. And so now we come to the actual most recent announcement from this project, using some of the most advanced techniques we can imagine, using a lot of telescopes, a lot of data analysis, and a lot of computers with tons and tons of processing power, trying to determine if there's anything out there. And, well, as you can see from the title here, using 1,327 nearby stars with this specific frequency, we've unfortunately discovered that no one is trying to talk to us, no one is sending any signals to us, and, well, unfortunately, it seems that either everyone is super quiet or there's just no one there. And I highly encourage you to kind of go through some of the paper and read some of the techniques that they use, because they're actually really, really advanced and very interesting. And here, from the entire sample of roughly around 1,702 stars near us, the 1,327 nearby stars were unfortunately devoid of any signals. And the interesting thing is that there were some potential signals that they were not sure about, and so they actually used a lot of follow-up studies and follow-up examination techniques to determine that all of them, without exception, were actually coming from either earthly sources, in other words, maybe someone using a smartphone near the actual telescope, or satellites passing overhead and sending radio signals to us. In other words, none of those signals were coming from planets or stars in the distance. And one of the ways that they determine all of this is by using billions of various radio channels to try to actually establish where the source of the signal is. They also made sure that the actual signal was not moving across the skies, because this would probably be an airplane or some kind of a satellite if it was moving too fast. So every signal they looked at was unfortunately that. It was just not coming from stars or planetary objects or galaxies. And although on the one hand, it's sort of sad that we didn't discover anything, on the other hand, it sort of also gives me a sense of relief that there is no unknown species trying to talk to us right now, because I don't think we're ready for it just yet. Now, very interestingly though, this doesn't necessarily disagree with the super famous Drake's equation, simply because we've only taken a look at roughly around 1,300 stars. That's not even close to the total number of stars in the galaxy, but as I showed you in the beginning, because of the actual distances involved and because of how slow light travels, there's also a very high chance that by the time that we actually hear something from the aliens or they hear something from us, either our species will be extinct or theirs will be. And this, of course, is one of the famous answers to the Drake's equation. It's very likely that we just don't live long enough to hear anything from anyone. Nevertheless, though, Project Breakthrough Listen is still going to be going on for at least 7 more years, and there's still a chance that we might be able to discover something. Now, personally, I don't think we'll hear anything, but nevertheless, what we're going to be doing in the next 7 years is developing some incredible techniques that will definitely help us in some other ways in the future. The amount of new, really awesome scientific techniques that were created just to be able to do this is already mind-blowing. And so by the end of the project in 2026, it's very likely that we'll develop ways to communicate, at least here in the solar system, that will actually help us colonize other planets and spread humanity, at least here in a little bubble around the sun. But until that happens, and until we actually learn how to communicate better, how to listen better, and most importantly, how to actually colonize planets, we're going to keep learning, keep trying, and keep trying new techniques. I'm actually really excited about where science is headed in the next few decades. And I'm also really excited that a lot of billionaires and a lot of scientists joined this project to either support it financially or to support it scientifically. And the way I see it personally is that there's really no way to lose this. We're still going to gain something from all of this. And even though some people might think that this is actually a waste of money and time, I'm fairly certain that by the time that all of these projects are complete, we're going to come up really, really knowledgeable and a lot better ourselves. We're going to learn a lot from it and establish new techniques that will take us to further levels, further studies, and new exploration, and maybe one day extraterrestrial intelligence that we finally discover using some kind of a mind-blowing technique that we don't even have just yet. For now though, I guess we're just gonna keep looking, keep listening, and keep learning. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be discussing the idea of the Hubble constant, the very famous constant that we use to try to establish how fast the universe is accelerating, as essentially maybe not being a constant after all. In other words, when it comes to understanding the universe, we're still kind of learning everything from scratch. So I remember when I took my first astrophysics class, I was essentially taught that the universe has this fundamental value inside of it that's predicted by Einstein's field equation. And Einstein used to refer to this as his biggest blunder because he couldn't figure it out. There was a number in his equation and it didn't make sense to him. Eventually, we realized that this so-called cosmological constant could be an actual property of the universe, suggesting that our universe is accelerating with time. It's growing faster and faster and faster the more we progress through time. And this is also something that was only discovered in 1998, and the discoverers of this were awarded the Nobel Prize. Now, today we're not really talking about this. We're talking about something related to this, known as the Hubble constant. Or essentially the idea of measuring the speed of expansion of the universe using the constant that we've been measuring in the last few decades quite thoroughly. And to try to understand what Hubble constant means, all we need to do is basically take a look at the Milky Way right here and then move to the Andromeda galaxy, which is roughly around 2.5 million light years away from us, with the Milky Way being this tiny galaxy you might see right there in the corner. And according to the Hubble constant, at this distance, the Andromeda galaxy is technically moving away from us at a speed of about 51 kilometers per second. That's based on the constant of 67 kilometers per second for every 3.26 million light years. So essentially, the actual space here is receding from us at this speed. 51 kilometers per second is pretty fast. But because the Andromeda galaxy is also moving really fast toward us, technically it's eventually going to catch up to us and collide with our galaxy. But because of this, a lot of other galaxies are actually moving away from us and will never come close to the Milky Way. There are very few galaxies that are moving toward the Milky Way, and the vast majority will slowly move away until they reach a point in a few billion years when we never see them again. And if you'd like to learn more about this concept, you can check out one of the videos I made previously. But what is important here is that a very recent study from only a few weeks ago, along with several other studies that have been coming out in the last year, started to discover something really unusual. The Hubble constant doesn't seem to be a constant. It seems to actually change with the location, the time, and the direction we look at. So for example, the value I mentioned previously of 67-ish kilometers per second is based on the so-called oldest light in the universe. It's based on this, the cosmic microwave background. And this is something we've always taken for granted. However, some of the other observations, for example from the nearby Large Magellanic Cloud, discovered a slightly different constant. I believe it was actually a little bit higher than that. Then we started looking around and discovered even more discrepancy. And so this paper here decided to do something completely different. They decided to just crunch the numbers, basically making it a kind of a blind study where you don't really know the answer until the end. And no matter what answer they get, they're going to publish it based on pure math, nothing else but math, no corrections. And to make sure that they were getting different results from different locations, they've taken a look at three gravitationally lensed quasars that are pretty well known to us and that have been very thoroughly studied already. And these quasars are all listed here, and essentially what you're looking at is something like this. It's a galaxy in front of another galaxy. The galaxy in front is much closer to us, but because of its mass, it's gravitationally lensing the light rays here, which eventually create the lens that we can then use to observe very distant objects. So there are actually two galaxies involved here, one being the lens, and one is the galaxy we're looking at. And the scientists behind this paper picked three different quasars, or three different very bright galaxies, at a relatively far away distance from us, but all of those distances were different, and all of the lenses were different, but the actual formula used were exactly the same. So technically, if the Hubble constant is constant, they should be getting exactly the same result. But because it's essentially a blind study, the results were not available to the scientists until the end. As you can probably guess from the title, the results were extremely inconsistent. So, at a distance of about 4.8 billion light years away from Earth, the closest quasar had the Hubble constant of about 82 kilometers per second. That's already way, way faster than what we've previously thought was possible. At a distance of about 6.8 billion light years away from us, the middle quasar had the Hubble constant of 77 kilometers per second, so a little bit lower. And at a distance of 8.8 billion light years, the farthest of the quasars had the Hubble constant of about 70 kilometers per second. So all three values were different, but at the same time, there seems to be a pattern. The farther away we are from Earth, the lower the Hubble constant becomes, suggesting that if we were to look at another galaxy that's even farther away, it could be closer to that value we see from the cosmic background radiation. And these results suggest that the closer galaxies to us expand a lot faster than the galaxies farther away, while at the same time suggesting that with time the actual constant changed quite dramatically. As a matter of fact, it seems to have increased over time. Now that's of course a bit of a problem for cosmology, but at the same time it's a growing field, so it's expected to have these blunders. And one explanation provided so far is that, well, maybe, like the study suggests, it's not a constant after all. Maybe it's actually some sort of a particle again that is causing all of this expansion. But at the same time, it could also be a problem with our understanding of the gravity itself when it comes to really, really, really far away distances. So in other words, we might have to rework the Einstein's models and try to figure out what is it that we're getting wrong from all of these models that we have. In other words, it's actually a pretty exciting time to study cosmology because it looks like we're not really sure what's happening, and there might be a lot of interesting discoveries coming in the next few years once we figure out why it's causing all of these results to come out so different from one another. But luckily for the scientists studying this, only a week ago from when I'm making this video, this new telescope here known as DESI became operational. The telescope whose main purpose is to study very thoroughly the idea of dark energy. In late October of 2019, it had its first light, as it's called. Essentially, it was able to take the first picture just to prove that it's working and that it's going to be able to hopefully solve the dark energy problem. Which also suggests that maybe sometime next year, around the same time, I'll be making another video, hopefully once and for all answering the question of what exactly is this Hubble constant? Is it constant? Did we finally figure out this whole expansion of the universe thing and this whole dark energy thing? And most importantly, how all of this relates to our daily lives. Right now, it really doesn't. But then again, many things in science that we use today and take for granted today were not really that important to most people when we were just studying them. So sometime in the next few decades, we'll probably find a way to use all of this in real life as well. Mysterious radio signals from space. Alien theory is understandable, say scientists. Hello, wonderful person. So I imagine it went something like this. This is the Chime Observatory in Canada, and we have a very important announcement. We have just detected a very strong radio wave source coming from another galaxy.
You're telling us you found aliens?
No, sir. We've just detected an unusual radio wave
So basically aliens?
Well, there is nothing to suggest that it's aliens. It's a radio wave source coming from another galaxy.
Uh-huh. So, aliens?
No, sir, please don't get confused. Radio waves doesn't actually mean radio communication. It just means...
Uh-huh, hold on a second. Everybody, they found aliens. Start the presses.
And this is why every major news source has been actually reporting this as if it's basically aliens. And unusually so, there is nothing to suggest that this word was even mentioned anywhere. The mysterious radio signals does imply that it's some kind of radio transmission. The alien theory started popping up here and there. And in the last 2 days, I've actually been hearing quite a lot of people basically suggesting that it's some sort of an alien communication. And so let's get straight to the facts and talk about how, well, first of all, not aliens. And second of all, actually not really that important, because we still don't really know what's causing these particular radio signals. So first of all, what we've actually detected was a repeated fast radio burst, also known as FRB, coming from a galaxy about 1.5 billion light years away from us. And what made this particular detection kind of interesting is that it's the second ever repeated FRB. In other words, it's an FRB that happened more than once on several occasions and seems to be coming from the same sort of point in space. Most of the time, FRBs have actually been only detected once, but this is the second one that's basically repeated. And the first one was actually detected back in 2015. And so this event was actually detected by this right here. This is the Chime telescope located in the west part of Canada. And it's essentially a series of telescopes, radio telescopes specifically, that were just started last year. And as soon as they were started, we started detecting these FRBs. And what's really, really unusual and what's really interesting is that we are now pretty certain that these events happen pretty much on a regular basis, and just we haven't really been detecting them very accurately. But we think that now we'll be able to detect quite a lot of them coming from different parts of the universe. Now, I briefly showed you this, and this is actually kind of a segue to explain why there's talk of extraterrestrials. When we just detected the first ever pulsar, which is this is actually one of the most famous pulsars known as Cygnus X3, the first ever detection was kind of unofficially known as LGM1, Little Green Man 1, because people thought that these radio transmissions or these radio pulses were coming from extraterrestrial life. With time, we realized that it was actually a completely natural source, and it was really formed by this very powerful, very, very dense object known as a neutron star. And we think that there's a slight chance, actually, so far it's probably the best explanation, for what's causing FRBs as well. We think FRBs that have been detected in the past few years are caused in some way by a very, very, very magnetized neutron star, also known as a magnetar. There's actually quite a lot of different speculations about what really is happening, but for the most part, the scientists think that it's either A, there's a binary object, like for example, possibly a white dwarf that's losing some of its mass, and the mass is actually falling onto the magnetar and then basically gets expulsed via these astrophysical jets that you see here. And on the other hand, maybe just maybe the actual magnetar is flying through a system of asteroids. Maybe it's passing through an asteroid belt, and as it passes through the asteroid belt, some asteroids fall onto it and thus create this energy that we see billions of light years away from us. Now, on the other hand, it's also possible that it's an interaction between a black hole and a neutron star. But why neutron star? Why are we so certain that it's actually, or most likely, a magnetar? The reason for this is because the light that we're receiving from there, basically the actual radio bursts, are highly, highly twisted.
twisted and folded by something like a magnetic field, very powerful magnetic field. And we know that magnetars are the most powerful magnetic objects out there. So we are almost certain that it's got to be somehow related to this, a magnetar. Now, on the other hand, we are pretty sure that it's not a collision. It's not some kind of a catastrophic event that only happens once, like, for example, a collision between two neutron stars or two black holes. The reason we think it's not a cataclysm, basically, is because we've detected two events now that are repeated. And you know, you can't really have collisions happening over and over again. It just doesn't make sense. So it has to be a non-catastrophic, non-cataclysmic event that's repeatable. And this event is also extremely high in energy. As a matter of fact, a single event produces as much energy as our sun does in about 80 years. And at the same time, the frequency produced during these particular events is always very different. It's never really the same frequency. It's sort of like a multi-phase frequency of radio waves, which is why we are like 99.9% certain it has nothing to do with aliens. This is not a radio communication. This is not an artificial source. It's a natural source produced by some kind of a very powerful event. And all of these events are extremely bright, very powerful, and they're also very fast. They're called fast radio bursts because they only last a few milliseconds. If you were just listening for this event on your radio transmitter, you would not even notice it. It's just so fast. It's not even a snap of a finger. It's faster than that. So in a few milliseconds, you can maybe get like 50 of them, although usually what happens is that you get a single event, and then within the next few minutes, you get another one, within the next few minutes, you get another one, up to about an hour, you can get as many as 50. And we don't really know what's causing this because it's not a phenomenon we really understand yet. But nevertheless, this is actually something that we are definitely excited to study because, for all we know, it might be a phenomenon that could actually transform our lives. We could actually have found some kind of a new source of energy that we didn't really know about before, or maybe we discovered something that is totally beyond our expectations. So this is why, for scientists, this is an extremely exciting event. It's kind of like when the two black holes collided and we were able to detect their gravitational waves. But for a regular person living their regular lives, and even for a regular scientist working in the earth sciences, this is not really that important, unfortunately. Mostly because this is more of a theoretical physics field right now where we really need to try to understand this first. So, I'm sorry to be the bearer of the bad news, this is absolutely not the aliens. This is also not particularly that interesting to most people. However, depending on what's really causing this, this could actually transform our lives. If it is a magnetar just flying through an asteroid belt, then, well, it's actually kind of disappointing because it just doesn't really mean anything to us and it won't really help us with our regular lives. But if this is some kind of a new object that we didn't really know existed and is creating this very interesting energy, in that case, it could be something extremely interesting to us and may even help us eventually live better lives. But only the future will tell what this is all about. And hopefully we'll hear more about FRBs in 2019 because I honestly have been actually following this topic for a very long time. And you could probably explain everything about FRBs in like 2 pages of writing. That's how little we know about them. We literally know nothing. There are over 500 publications right now. And for the most part, they're just speculations, just kind of thoughts and observations. We don't really know what's happening. But it is very fun. And it's very, very, very exciting that maybe one day in the next few decades, we'll actually know for a fact what this is. Just like the pulsars, this could be actually a new object. Well, anyway, on that note, yeah, not aliens, but something really cool. Thank you for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed this video and hopefully you learned a little bit more about FRBs and specifically the detection of 2019 that had basically almost every media source going crazy. Yep, not aliens though. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about the mystery of dark matter. But more specifically, we're going to talk and look at a paper that discusses the death from dark matter.
In other words, it tries to investigate why is it that it seems that nobody has ever died from dark matter. And I guess we really should start with the fact that we still have no idea what dark matter really is. We only see the effects of dark matter by looking at the galactic speeds and how stars in various galaxies move. And we also see the effects of gravitational lensing when looking at distant objects, because some of them seem to have been sort of shifted and twisted by very, very dense gravitational attractors. But other than that, we don't really know what it is. For the longest time, the scientists used these really large, really expensive detectors, like this one right here. This is in South Korea, made in collaboration with Yale University, and they've spent billions and billions of dollars to try to discover these particles they refer to as WIMPs, also known as weakly interacting massive particles. So we haven't found anything. We don't really know how exactly dark matter works or what it's made out of. But some scientists started to speculate maybe we can learn more about it by looking at what we know as a fact. And the fact is that many different space phenomena out there have somehow affected human life, or maybe even endangered human life, sometimes almost killing humans. Like, for example, various space debris that we know constantly re-enters our planet. In at least one instance back in 1997, almost killed a person. This lady right here, Lottie Williams, who is seen in this picture holding this part of a launch of a rocket that basically almost hit her on the head, but luckily missed and hit her on the shoulder. And so to try to understand what dark matter might be, several scientists tried to write papers on what could potentially happen if dark matter killed a person. At least one paper back in 2012 investigated this in a little bit more detail to try to discover so what would really happen to human body if WIMPs basically hit through it, and what sort of interaction would WIMPs have with humans. And so what they discovered is that a typical human body would receive roughly around 10 WIMP collisions per year, with the most extreme sort of calculation of being one WIMP per minute. In other words, you would get hit with one little particle of dark matter every single minute. And this would result in something equivalent to background radiation that we all get right now from things like cosmic radiation, from things like radon, that's the gas all over the place on our planet. And it would be completely minuscule in comparison. In other words, you would not really feel any effect whatsoever. So for these WIMPs to kill human beings would be quite impossible. And so they kind of abandoned this idea, but then we had another new study that suggested that maybe dark matter is not made out of WIMPs. Maybe it's made of something called macro. Macro dark matter is kind of this new thing that's going on in science, where scientists realize that you can actually create bigger particles out of the same quarks and the same subatomic particles that make up regular matter, but it just so happens that you can make really, really, really large particles. And today scientists refer to this as macro dark matter. The paper from 2014 is in the description below if you want to learn a little bit more about it. But the idea here is pretty simple. You can hypothetically create particles that are extremely large in size. Some of them could be as big as, let's say, a golf ball. And they believe that it's possible that dark matter might be made of these unusual particles. And so the very recent paper that was released only a few weeks ago from when I'm making this video investigates this. They decided to approach this from the macro dark matter perspective, and they decided to find out what would happen to human body if suddenly you were hit by this macro dark matter coming out of outer space and hitting your body. Well, the calculation suggests that with certain types of macro dark matter, it would literally be equivalent to being hit by, well, what you see on the screen, a lightsaber. They compare it to this tremendously powerful, tremendously hot plasma cylinder that would pierce your body so fast and with so much power that there would be a hole in your body for no apparent reason. And this is of course interesting because nobody has ever been reported to die from this. And this paper is kind of speculative, very hypothetical, but creates a very important limit for what macro dark matter could be. It means that it cannot be certain things that would have killed many human beings around the planet. It means that it cannot be a certain mass or a certain size, and has to be a lot different. Because if it wasn't, a lot of people would have been already dead from these unusual, mysterious lightsaber strikes across the planet. And one of the reasons why dark matter could even do this to a human body is because it's not really affected by matter as much, but it does have energy in it, and as it passes through different objects, it would leave behind these really powerful bullet-like streaks of plasma that's roughly around 10 million degrees Celsius. So it would still have an effect, but it would just not really interact with the matter. And so by doing various calculations, the scientists behind this paper discovered that, well, there's definitely has to be a limit of size and mass for these macros, because otherwise we would see fatalities from dark matter everywhere. And they discovered that it has to be smaller than a micron, which is roughly around this big. Here is a micron compared to human hair. And it has to be less heavy or lighter than roughly around 50 kilograms or about 110 pounds. So in other words, these macros cannot really be heavier or bigger than that, because they would create these very fatal collisions. We would see these collisions everywhere, and it's very likely that a lot of people would be dead around the world from the collisions with macro dark matter. And even though this paper is very hypothetical, it's a really good start for how we can sort of pin down to what dark matter could be and then start looking for it. Because currently all of the dark matter detectors are only looking for WIMPs. None of them are looking for this macro dark matter, and we don't really even know what to look for. If it is a macro dark matter, how big does it have to be? How massive does it have to be? And so by looking around our planet, and also by looking at essentially the effects of this hypothetical dark matter, we might be able to pin down the sizes and also the masses involved, and then be able to detect it in more detail. Now, how exactly are we going to do this? Well, the paper suggests using people, but also using granite rocks. In other words, by looking around various rock formations, we might be able to see the actual marks from this superheated plasma that could then be used to track down the size and the mass of dark matter. But like I said, it's still really early in its discussion, and according to these scientists, they've only looked around the rocks in the vicinity of their university. They haven't even looked beyond or tried to analyze this in more sort of experimental and scientific way. Nevertheless though, if one day we discover an unusual lightsaber-like mark in a rock or in a person, we know that we may have discovered the elusive dark matter. But for now, that's all we really know. It's still very mysterious, still very elusive. We don't really know what it's made out of. We just know that it has effect on the universe, and very observable effect that's sort of hard to dispute. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be discussing a new unusual study and a new mystery that might resolve a lot of other mysteries. Today we'll talk about what are known as geodes, and something that might resolve the problem with dark energy, while at the same time explaining a few anomalies we've observed when black holes collided. So in the last few years, we were able to discover quite a lot of really cool things. For one, we actually got to take a picture of a black hole of a galaxy known as M87, and this black hole even has a name now, it's known as Powehi. At the same time, we've even observed things like stars being eaten or being absorbed by black holes, and we've seen many different black hole and neutron star collisions as well. All of this is something we've theoretically expected to happen, but finally we got to observe them using various new techniques and various new observatories out there. But at the same time, there are still a lot of unanswered questions. One of these unanswered questions is of course related to the so-called dark energy. The idea behind which I can explain to you very easily by basically taking a look at this simulation here. Today we understand that our universe is expanding, but for some reason it's also accelerating its expansion, and it's something that we are having trouble explaining. As an explanation, we've proposed this idea of dark energy, this unusual, I guess you can call it substance, that exists in the universe that's causing this acceleration, that's kind of pushing things apart more and more and more. And it's something that we've observed, but we just can't really explain it. At the same time, when it comes to black hole collisions, we've also seen quite a lot of them. But even the first collision we've ever seen was a little bit unusual. As a matter of fact, we've predicted these collisions to first of all be a little bit more rare, but at the same time we've expected the actual black holes to be much smaller, much less massive. The collisions we've observed were basically between black holes that were about 30 masses of the sun. And that's way more than we predicted. And it's something we couldn't really understand or explain. In other words, just to help you visualize this, even though we predicted it to be sort of like this, this is a typical black hole we thought we would see, we instead saw something like this. Much larger, much more massive black holes colliding, forming an even bigger black hole. And this is something that we kind of have taken for granted now, because we've observed a lot of these relatively large black holes. This is about 30 masses of the sun. But still, it's not really something we can explain theoretically. And so to try to explain all of this, the two scientists who published this paper decided to describe this in slightly different terms. They decided to combine ideas from the Soviet physicist who, back in 1966, when he was much younger than you see on the picture here, proposed the idea that, well, maybe, just maybe, certain black holes can actually become dark energy chunks. And today we refer to these objects as geodes, which stands for Generic Object of Dark Energy. And the idea here, well, is kind of difficult to explain mathematically. As a matter of fact, when I was reading this paper, there was so much math in it that I had to take a very long break and then come back and try to finish it. But in essence, imagine it's an object that, instead of being a black hole, is actually made out of this dark energy. And even though it sort of appears as a black hole from the outside, inside of it is a different story. Inside, it's basically all just dark energy matter, or I guess dark energy substance? Dark energy. And to try to explain all of this, the scientists in this paper propose that everything in the universe is essentially kind of connected. Basically, the black holes and the dark energy, they all influence each other. And when these geodes are created, they sort of start influencing the rest of the universe and pushing everything apart. And so in a sense, they are suggesting that there's an interconnection between these really small compact objects like black holes and more specifically geodes and the rest of the cosmos, the rest of the universe. And so as a consequence here, what this suggests is that the growth of the universe itself actually kind of dictates what happens to the stars when they die, if they become black holes or if they become geodes. And according to the scientists behind this paper, even if just 1 out of 100 black holes is a geode, which might look something like this, and if just one of these black holes is a geode, it would be enough to explain the effects of dark energy that we're observing across the universe. And honestly, this is actually a pretty interesting discovery, or at least a pretty interesting theoretical mathematical analysis. So here, a single black hole as a geode is enough to explain what we're observing, and enough to explain the anomalies we've seen in LIGO black hole mass detection. In other words, if two of these black holes collide, and they're not really black holes, but they're geodes, they would produce the masses that were observed. Because according to them, if you were to look at these geodes from a distance, from a faraway distance where these two geodes collided, they would actually appear more massive than they really are. And so this is kind of how they explain both the anomalies in the LIGO detection and the so-called dark energy that they believe might be all connected to these unusual objects. These geodes would also kind of grow in size with the universe, until basically the collision occurs. And so in a sense, these objects are literally like a connection to the rest of the universe. As the universe grows and expands even more, so do these geodes and of course their influence on the rest of the universe. But of course, this is all very theoretical right now. It's basically all mathematical even. There is unfortunately no actual evidence that this might be true. And even if these geodes do exist, we have no idea what's inside of them. We don't even know how to possibly find them, because they would kind of appear like a typical black hole. As a matter of fact, the scientists behind this paper even suggested that maybe the Puhwehi black hole in the middle of M87 is also a geode. It would appear a lot more massive from this distance, but in reality it could be basically made of dark energy. But unfortunately, there's really no proof. I'm sure it would probably take years before more scientists will join and try to analyze their study and also try to come up with maybe some observational proofs. For now, we don't really know, but of course it's a good explanation to both dark energy and the unusual observations that we've seen. If, however, the scientists behind this paper are correct in their assumption, it really means that maybe, just maybe, just one single black hole being a geode is enough to explain the effects we're seeing with dark energy. And it also means that This Soviet physicist was way ahead of his time and trying to explain something that we didn't even know existed back then, because we've only realized dark energy might be a thing in 1998, but he came up with this idea back in 1966. So once upon a time, when I think I was about 6 years old, I was full of questions, like most kids, and I asked my mom a question. I said, "Mom, how big is the universe?" Now, I think I was just learning about stars back then, and I was kind of discovering all of these concepts. And because I was full of questions, my mom probably didn't want to answer all of this. So she said, "Son, it's infinite." And because it was such a brilliant answer, it actually created more questions, of course, but I didn't really ask them. Instead, what my mom didn't really realize is that I started dreaming and I started exploring and I started asking all of these questions that essentially led me to where I am today. But that night, when I was six, I still remember how I was actually lying in bed and trying to imagine. I was trying to imagine, how can it be infinite? What if I flew through universe really, really, really fast? And let's do this right now, because we can, because this is Space Engine. If I flew through universe really fast, would I reach the edge? Would I see something different there? Would things be different? Now, those questions were never answered. They're still not known to us. I'm still dreaming, I'm still trying to imagine, but it's difficult. And today we're actually going to try to imagine what you would really see at the edge of the universe. Now, to start our adventure, we're going to do a little bit of imagining and also a little bit of simulationing. That's not really a word, but never mind. So first, why is it that you would actually see exactly the same? Well, let me give you an example. So let's say you're going hiking and you stand on top of a hill and you look around yourself and you basically see, you know, something like this. There's a horizon in the distance, there's a bunch of houses, there's a bunch of other hills, and all around you, you kind of see this, but you also see this edge that is kind of there. This is what we call the horizon. And this is actually one of the reasons why for many, 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 many years, people believed that there was actually the edge of the world. There was the end of the world. And you could basically fall off the edge of the world. And you could also discover some incredible creatures maybe somewhere near it. Well, now, today, for the most part, almost all of us know that this is not true. As a matter of fact, if you were to go to the edge of this world in this picture and to then look around yourself, you would now see a different picture with new buildings, new hills, but you would also see the old hill where you used to be standing, except now it's at the edge of this world. So as you can see, no matter where you go on the planet, you always have this edge of your vision, but at the same time, you always kind of have new stuff to look at. And something similar to this happens here in the universe as well, except that edge, the visible edge, is much, much larger. So when you are looking at our universe from the beautiful planet Earth right here, what you're looking at is essentially very similar to what you saw on the hill. You're looking at the stars and planets, and then far, far away at a distance of about 47 billion light years in every single direction, you're going to see the edge, the visible edge. This visible edge is actually formed by the limit of the speed of light and not really by the actual shape of the universe. And in every direction, in no matter where you are looking from, and basically no matter where you are in the universe, you're going to see new stars, new planets, and, well, essentially what you're seeing here, but maybe from a slightly different perspective. Now, luckily for us, in Space Engine right here, we do have this visible edge of the universe. So you can actually even go there and imagine what it might be like, except that, of course, it only represents the observable universe that we have right now. So here, if I actually accelerate to dramatic, dramatic speeds and escape our galaxy and then move far, far, far away, I'm going to reach the edge of observable universe. But of course, this is actually not the reality that I would see if I was there. Now, let's just go there first. It's actually going to take us a while to get there because, like I said, it's pretty far away from us. Nevertheless, though, you can definitely reach it in the simulation. Now, at this speed, which is about 280 million light years per second, it's going to basically take me around a minute or so to get to where I'm going. And once I get there, what I'm going to see is, well, essentially empty space. Now, this is because we don't really know what's after this. We have no idea what's here. Theoretically, we believe that it's just more galaxies, more planets, and more stars. But we have no means of actually seeing it. The speed of light doesn't allow us because Since the creation of the universe, since the Big Bang, some things moved away so far away and so quick that they actually escaped our visible universe, our observable universe. And because our universe also expands and accelerates, it practically becomes impossible for us to ever see those objects. Now, that's actually a topic for another video, because there's a lot of explaining to do on why is it that the universe is also expanding and accelerating, why the universe is exactly 40 or approximately 47 billion light years in radius, and what may be happening outside of it. But I actually found a picture from a really old book that kind of shows you visually what may be happening here. So we have the observer on Earth right in the middle, and then we have the observable universe of about, well, it says 45 billion, but it's really close to 47 billion light years. And everything outside of this is unknown to us, but we assume that it's more stuff. Now, we don't really know how much of stuff, and we don't really know what kind of stuff, but we do know that, or we do think we know, that it's about the same stuff as we see in our own observable universe. So, for all we know, there might be another person right here standing and looking at their observable universe that's actually outside of our universe, and they could be wondering the same thing. But because the universe is constantly expanding and accelerating its expansion, we'll actually never see each other. Now, a very common way of trying to imagine what's really happening with the universe and how it's actually expanding is to, well, essentially imagine a balloon. And maybe on this balloon you can actually draw a few stars that would represent the galaxies or stars or planets that have formed in this particular early universe. And then as the universe expands, the distance between stars starts increasing. And as the universe starts expanding, the distance between these stars also starts expanding as well. Now, this is actually something that was proven several times, and this is something we refer to as the Hubble law, the law of expanding universe. And this is also something that we were able to calculate pretty precisely in the last few years, specifically using the Hubble telescope. But the problem with this particular analogy is that, well, first of all, this makes people assume that the center of the ball is the actual center of the universe. At the same time, it also kind of does create the idea of the edge of the ball and the actual ball or the balloon expanding into something, into another dimension. But the reality is that the math behind this particular idea does not require any of those concepts. You don't need to have the center. The center is literally everywhere. You don't really need to have another dimension to expand into, even though technically you could have for something to universe to expand into, it doesn't have to be so. And lastly, the edge itself that you see on the ball is not necessary either. Like I mentioned before, if you were to stand on a hill, the edge is in one location if you're standing here, but in a completely different location if you're on another hill. So there is no actual edge. The observable edge is there, but it's not an actual physical location. And this is why mathematics, in a sense, is the beautiful solution to the universe. It allows us to perfectly manipulate these concepts that our brains just can't grasp. So, mathematically, the universe is expanding in every direction from every point in space, and it does not need to have another dimension to expand into. It's sort of expanding into itself, and it also does not need to have any edge anywhere. But I guess we sort of deviated from the course here. The question I was asking is, so what would you see from the edge of the universe? So basically, if I were to go far, far away at a distance of 47 billion light years from Earth, what would I actually see there? So right now I picked a random procedurally generated galaxy that's practically at the distance of about 45 billion light years away from us. And we're going to be looking around and essentially seeing, well, the same stuff. Well, actually no, different stuff, but similar visual things. We see the stars, we see the galaxies. But then what if we were to actually look back to where Earth was? What would we see then? Now that's a different question, because the answer to that is nothing. We would see absolutely nothing. If I were to look back to where our planet Earth was located from where we actually came, if we were there right now, literally if this was like a teleportation situation where you instantly transport yourself to this location, you would be looking at a location that's about 13.8 billion years old. Earth did not exist back then. This is actually about 8 billion years before Earth was created. As a matter of fact, the Milky Way most likely also didn't exist, or if it did, it was really tiny and looked completely different. So, in a sense, we would actually see something completely, completely different from what we're used to seeing. But most importantly is that none of the molecules that created Earth and none of the stuff that's in your body was actually even created yet. It took quite a lot of supernova to actually get there. Because remember, we're looking at the edge of the universe, so you're actually looking in the past, and so you're looking at stuff that happened practically right after the Big Bang. Okay, so this was under the assumption that this was instant teleportation. How about if we actually got here, like, I guess, in 47 billion years from now? Or essentially, we would get there when the light that leaves Earth right now gets there. So what would we see then? Once again, nothing. And the reason for this is, once again, the actual expansion of the universe and also the acceleration of the expansion of the universe that's caused by the very mysterious dark energy. Because of this, practically as soon as you start looking in this direction, you realize that the Milky Way and the Earth and the Sun and everything that we know and love so dearly has actually disappeared behind the horizon of the observable universe and will no longer be seen again. Now, this is actually a very interesting concept, but it stems from the idea that our universe doesn't just expand, it's actually accelerating its expansion. In other words, the actual balloon is growing faster and faster and faster as it sort of inflates. So essentially, as the universe itself expands, it ends up hiding things that are currently at the edge of the observable universe. And if Earth was located there right now, by the time that the light from Earth gets to the location where we were just standing, you're going to see nothing. The light will actually never reach the location. It will be always sort of beyond the edge of the observable universe. And this is also very kind of hard to imagine and I guess understand, but this is something we once again found mathematically. Essentially, pretty much everything at the edge of the universe is slowly disappearing from the view. And this also means that in about a trillion years from now, we're going to see no other galaxy. And this is something I've covered in the video previously. I've actually talked about things that will no longer be even visible in trillion years. But the idea of a galaxy, another galaxy, to aliens living trillion years from now will be completely incomprehensible. They will not know what they are and that they even were a thing. And so in this sense, the so-called edge of the universe that you see right here is a very fascinating concept. It is a kind of an imaginary concept. It's only based on the fact that we have this visible edge that is created by the speed of light. But it's also a concept that helps us understand the limits of our knowledge of the entire universe. We have no idea if the universe is infinite. We have no idea if it's something that sort of loops and comes back to the same location. And we don't really know what's beyond the edge, and we will probably never know, because as of today, as of the current technology, there is absolutely no way for us to ever see beyond the edge of the universe. The only way we could actually potentially see beyond the edge of the universe is if we were to somehow literally teleport to the location of the edge. In other words, if we were to shrink the space-time and to kind of use a warp-like technology to find ourselves at the edge of the universe, in which case we would see past it. We would actually see what's beyond the observable universe. However, there's actually a lot of really interesting papers that try to understand what happens beyond the edge based on the activity of galaxies very, very close to the edge. And going back to the picture I just showed you, there is actually a very interesting dense patch of space-time that seems to be attracting galaxies from the edge here. It's essentially almost as if something was sucking those galaxies into this unknown thing or object or whatever beyond the visible edge. And so that way we can actually maybe try to understand what's happening here. But once again, without actually seeing what's doing this, we'll probably never know. And to answer the question that was asked in the beginning of the video, what would you actually see from the edge of the universe if you looked into the night skies? Well, this. You would see this. You would see stars. You would see something resembling the Milky Way. And you would also see your own new sun. However, all of this would be unfamiliar because we're in a completely different location, in a different system, somewhere far, far, far away. Now, interestingly, Space Engine allows us to basically imagine all of this and to go there and to actually look at it. And if you didn't know, Space Engine was actually absolutely free. So do check out the program and download it and try it for yourself. And maybe even support the developer because he's been putting a lot of years into this and is doing this basically for no pay whatsoever. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. Hopefully now you know a little bit more about the edge of the universe, the expansion and the inflation of the universe, and most importantly, what the observable universe is like and what you would actually see at the end of it. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about the part of the universe that we almost never talk about. The really, really dark and very mysterious part of the intergalactic space. Today I'm going to talk about what we know about it, but I guess there's going to be a lot of things that we still don't. Many years ago, when I was still teaching, I asked my students a question. Where do you think most of the matter in the universe hides in? Where do you think we can find most of the so-called baryonic or visible matter? And almost automatically, pretty much most of them said that it's in black holes, supermassive or ultramassive black holes like the one you see on the screen. This is Sagittarius A star in the middle of our own galaxy. The thing is, that's not even remotely close to the truth. As a matter of fact, we need to really go far, far away before we discover where most of that mass is. So first of all, only a very small fraction of mass is represented by black holes, because a lot of the mass in the universe is still sort of in gas form. It's basically free-floating. It hasn't really become a star or was a star and then exploded and this mass was released again. So most of the mass is really just dust and gas like you see on the screen right here, although this is a slightly more exaggerated, more beautiful version of it. Most of it would not even be visible. But also at the same time, if we really wanted to discover the biggest source of mass, we would have to go outside of our own galaxy. We would have to go into the middle of the empty space known as intergalactic medium. So today we're going to be talking about what is really happening here in between galaxies and why this is most likely one of the biggest mysteries we still have, but also hides a lot of answers to the, well, everything. Whatever we discover here in the intergalactic medium is actually a lot more important than what we discover in the middle of our own galaxy. So let's begin with the rough representation of the shape of everything in the universe. And what you're looking at here is a randomly selected cube, roughly around 100 or several hundred million light years across. And this is the representation of the visible matter in our universe. And every little thread that you see, that's essentially the so-called galactic filaments. Now, it might be a little bit difficult to imagine what we're looking at here until we use a simulation known as the Illustris Project, which allows us to simulate universe by sort of visualizing various types of radiation spectrum and also, of course, dark matter. So this is what galaxies would look like. There is a randomly generated elliptical galaxy in the middle there, a few other smaller galaxies around it. And if we were to look at the distribution of gas here, you would see that there's actually a lot of gas present pretty much everywhere around the galaxy as well. But what's more interesting here is if you were to zoom out, with the galaxy still being right there in the middle, but very, very small now, you would notice that there's actually a lot more gas all over the place in the middle of nowhere. And if we also start looking at dark matter here, we'll realize that they form kind of like these tunnel-like formations that we refer to as the galactic filaments. And these are some of the largest structures out there in the universe. And along these tunnels or along these filaments are other galaxies. So pretty much every major galaxy out there in the universe is connected with these filaments filled with gas, occasional stars, a lot of dark matter, and if we were to zoom out here a little bit more, you would start seeing these formations pretty much everywhere. Now, if I were to remove the gas and only leave the stars behind, this is really what it kind of looks like. This is just the dark matter and the visible matter, which is kind of what you're looking at here as well, except that this is in three dimensions. And for the most part, if you were to remove all of the galaxies from the picture, you would still be left with roughly around 80% of the entire mass of the universe. And we're talking about baryonic mass only, not even dark matter or anything. So essentially, there is more stuff out there that makes up stars and us, of course, that is outside of galaxies than inside those galaxies. So all of this intergalactic space, basically space between galaxies like Milky Way and the Andromeda, is filled with these filaments that you see, and inside of them there's quite a lot of stuff just kind of staying there, and most of the stuff is actively interacting with each other. A lot of it is made up of what's known as ionized hydrogen, mostly because these regions of space are very, very hot and they create these very highly energized molecules. And a lot of this gas is essentially plasma, the same stuff that you see when you're looking at the sun. Now, it's not as hot as the sun, and it's obviously not as dense as the sun, but it obeys the same principles and still is relatively active as well. And one of the ways we've discovered all of this is because when we were looking at objects known as quasars, these really, really, really bright, active black hole galaxies that emit a tremendously powerful beam of light, we realized that something was absorbing some of their light, but there was nothing in between those galaxies and us. And as the light from these quasars was passing through these filaments toward our own galaxy, some of the light spectrum was absorbed by hydrogen that it passed through. And we were able to observe this and realize that these filaments are pretty much everywhere. And what's really cool about some of this gas is that it's never actually reacted with anything, in a sense that it never formed any stars or any other objects. In other words, this gas has always been there since the beginning of the universe. And some of it will stay there forever. It will never become a star or any other object, simply because our universe is expanding and this gas is slowly moving farther and farther and farther away from pretty much every major object in the universe. So some of these molecules will always stay just lonely little molecules. But anyway, what else do we know about this? So first of all, as I mentioned, these filaments form pretty much these major structures in the universe, and some of them are some of the biggest structures we've ever seen, hundreds of millions of light years across, spanning almost the entire size of the universe. In between these structures, however, there are these really unusual voids. Now, one of the biggest requests I get on the channel is to talk about the Butes void, because I've never officially made a video about it. But I have made a video that you can check out somewhere above my head about the so-called local void, which I don't seem to see here, and that's because it's actually a lot smaller and a lot closer to us. But you can see it in this picture with our galaxy being right there in the middle. So these voids are the empty space, or the relatively empty space, in between these filaments. And essentially what you're looking at here can be sort of looked at in this way as well. We have these very, very large formations known as filaments, galaxies connected to them, and then in between these filaments we get these very large voids, with the closest one being the local void. Butes void is probably one of the more famous ones, but local void is a lot more important to us because it's right on our doorsteps. And inside of those voids, once in a while we do find a galaxy or two, but for the most part they're kind of empty and don't really have much gas in them at all. And even in those filaments that I previously mentioned, the density of the gas is not very high. You could, for all intents and purposes, call it vacuum. As a matter of fact, it's even less than vacuum. Let me give you a comparison. If we were to take a cubic centimeter of volume, which is really, really small, it's just a little bit smaller than a typical sugar cube, and create vacuum inside of this using the best technology we have here on Earth, there would still be roughly around 10 billion atoms on the inside. So even though we call it vacuum, it's not really vacuum. Then let's compare this to the middle of interstellar space, where Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 probes are right now. Here, vacuum can be anywhere between one particle per cubic centimeter to roughly around 1 million particles inside of these nebular clouds. So it's a lot less than what we can create here on Earth, but still, once again, not really vacuum. It still has at least a few atoms inside. However, if you were to leave the galaxy and then move to the region known as intergalactic space, this is when things get a little bit more interesting. The vacuum here drops dramatically. Here, you would only discover one single atom in a cubic meter of space. And essentially, there are roughly around 10,000 times less atoms than in the middle of the galaxy. And that's, of course, where it becomes really interesting, because even though the density of atoms is much less here in the intergalactic space, because there is so much of that space and because there are so many atoms out there, it still forms about 50 to maybe 80% of total mass of the universe. So if you were to combine all of the intergalactic mass into one, it would be bigger than all of the galaxies together. And for many years now, we've been detecting these unusual interactions between various light coming into our galaxy, including the fast radio bursts, FRBs, that seem to be influenced by various parts of galactic filament as they pass through it. And the more interaction we see, the easier it becomes for us to map it and to start understanding the real structure of the universe. Not just a typical galaxy, the whole universe. Everything in it, including the mysterious dark matter and, of course, the visible matter known as baryonic matter. But none of this matter just kind of stays there. As a matter of fact, most of the intergalactic matter constantly interacts with various galaxies. The best way to describe this interaction is by showing you a galactic collision, although this is more of a very dramatic example, but here, most galaxies, they actually absorb this intergalactic matter into themselves constantly, and they always get this gas as a kind of a replenishment for all of the gas they use up to make up other stars. So as the galaxy, as a typical galaxy, forms stars, and for example our own Milky Way forms roughly around 1.6 masses of the Sun every single year, all of this gas has to come from somewhere, and it usually comes from the intergalactic space through these connections via galactic filaments. So, in some sense, all of the galaxies are essentially connected. We're literally connected through these invisible bridges, and one day maybe we'll find a way to use them to travel across galaxies. But like, really far from now, because we have no idea what's even in there. But more recently, we even started discovering things like magnetic fields in them, and a lot of other really interesting things like stars that we normally find in the middle of galaxies. And some of these stars are very important for us, such as, for example, Cepheid variables, that we often use for mapping galaxies and for determining distances. So there's a lot of really unique and a lot of really interesting things going on in these filaments in between galaxies. And even more, we've discovered many different stars in the intergalactic medium, including stars between our own galaxy and the Andromeda. There are at least 670 stars that have already been confirmed, and I'm sure we'll find more as we keep looking. But even today, we still have more questions about this part of the universe than we have answers. There are still a lot of questions about the mysterious dark matter, a lot of questions about how these filaments were formed to begin with, and many other questions related to the eventual fate and the evolution of the entire universe as it kind of flies apart and becomes bigger and bigger. So we believe that one day maybe the universe does kind of rip apart, and this means that all of these filaments will disappear as well. For now though, we don't really know. But what we can do today is continuously study these galactic filaments and of course the mysterious voids, and at the same time simulate them here on Earth using supercomputers. And this way we'll be able to one day understand what's going on and how all of this will evolve in the next few billion years. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to try to answer yet another mystery, this time related to the so-called OMG particle, but in more general terms about these really high energy particles that once in a while strike our planet Earth. So quite a long time ago, basically in 1991, we've discovered this unusual particle that was detected by a facility in Utah that was referred to as the OMG particle, mostly because of the amount of energy that it produced. Now, to give you a kind of a visual representation, imagine taking a baseball and literally condensing it to the size of an atom, while of course maintaining the mass of that baseball as well. And then taking that baseball and launching it at a speed of about 100 kilometers per hour or about 60 miles per hour. So in other words, if we were to launch a baseball but it was atomic in size but yet have a mass of a baseball, this is how much energy is inside of these so-called particles. But if this baseball then struck your body, it would very likely pretty much go through your entire body and dislodge every single atom in your body that it passed through without any difficulty. And today we've detected about 72 of these particles as of 2019, and we refer to them as ultra high energy cosmic rays. So in other words, it's kind of like typical cosmic rays that we get every single second here on the planet, but usually about 20 to maybe even 50 million times more powerful. And so these are really powerful energetic events that we've been detecting around the planet, but their origin has always been a bit of a mystery because many of them seem to come from regions of space where there doesn't seem to be anything. And specifically, let me show you where one of these regions is from planet Earth. So here's our planet Earth, and if we were to look somewhere in here, okay, I'm going to cheat a little bit and have to bring up the constellations just to see where I'm looking at. So the so-called Ursa Major, or the Big Dipper, seems to be the source of many of these unusually high energy events. So these really high energy particles are coming from somewhere in here. The only thing is that if you were to zoom in, there doesn't seem to be many things here that could produce these very high energy events. And so we're kind of confused about what's really happening here, because we always believe that these high energy particles should be really coming from some really extreme environments, like for example, middle of an ultra-massive black hole, like the super famous M87 black hole that we've taken a picture of. And so these events should be energetic enough to produce something like an OMG particle. But this is unfortunately not what we're seeing, and we're detecting these events from regions of space that don't really have anything particularly powerful near them. And theoretically, the biggest source of these unusual particles should really be a radio galaxy. A galaxy that's similar to what you see on the screen, that's extremely powerful and is producing these very, very powerful astrophysical jets, even more powerful than M87. But it just so happens that only some of these particles were emanating from the region known to us that to have radio galaxies. The rest are coming from the darkness of space and the regions that are not really interesting. Which is why this new study that was recently released from Korean researchers might finally solve this mystery. It might finally explain what's really happening here, and it includes some really mind-blowing concepts. But first, let's talk about what they actually propose and what we need to know to understand this paper. And first of all, the scientists behind this paper are now absolutely certain that these ultra-high energy cosmic rays are coming from very known sources, like for example, M87 could be one of them, or any other radio galaxy somewhere out there in the Virgo cluster, basically the regions near us. So a lot of these well-known radio galaxies are probably the source for them. But how is it possible for these unusual rays to come from directions much, much farther away from these galaxies, from basically the source? And this is where the Korean scientists were able to identify how all of this is happening. So first of all, it's really important to understand that all of the galaxies in the cluster we're in are technically connected with what's known as galactic filaments. Now, these are really, really massive, really large structures, usually hundreds of millions of light years across, and it's technically also some of the biggest structures in the universe. It's a little bit difficult to see them, but you'll notice that here are some of these so-called galactic filaments. Basically, think of them as webs that cross the entire universe and form this beautiful formation. One of the better ways of visualizing all of this is using the Illustra simulation. And here, if I were to just enable the certain elements of the universe, you'll see how all of this forms the filaments across the entire universe. Now, all of this is simulated, but the idea and the actual observations do suggest that these filaments are everywhere. And you'll notice that these little spots here, these are the galaxies. And the filaments are more or less invisible in regular light, so this is what the regular light looks like. But as soon as we look at the gas distribution, or more specifically start analyzing the dark matter distribution, you'll notice that this is where these filaments become visible. So this is what they're made out of. They're made out of very large chunks of dark matter and have a lot of various gas in them. So we know that these filaments exist, and we have quite a lot of proof that they're out there and they connect galaxies, but we don't really know much else about them. And the scientists behind this paper use them to explain what's happening to these ultra-high energy particles. And according to these scientists, as these ultra-high energy particles leave the source, usually a radio galaxy, like for example, even galaxy like M87, some of them end up flying through these filaments, but despite their high energy, they're still just particles, and so many different things, specifically highly magnetic things, can change their direction at any time. And eventually, as they fly through these filaments and as they interact with various things in them, they might get diverted and end up coming closer and closer to our planet, and then eventually enter the atmosphere and collide with planet Earth. The main idea can be summarized by this image released by the scientists. We have the source of the ultra-high energy cosmic rays. The rays travel across the universe and may actually travel for a very, very long time, changing their direction many, many times, and they travel through these filaments until something scatters them back and they enter our galaxy and then cross our planet Earth. And so the scientists behind this paper believe that what we're detecting are the particles that were scattered by various events in these filaments, And thus we're looking at the interaction between ultra-high energy particles and something inside those filaments that caused them to change direction. Which by itself actually raises a lot of questions as well. What could have possibly caused them to change direction? But that's of course not something they cover in this paper. Instead, what they do focus on is explaining what we're looking at and of course answer the question that drove scientists crazy for many years. And so it seems that it's these filaments that are responsible for carrying these ultra-high energy particles, and all of them probably came from objects like the by now very famous galaxy known as M87 with its ridiculously powerful black hole in the middle. But what's really crazy about all of this, due to the actual speed of these particles, and this is kind of where it blew my mind when I did the math behind this, if you were to travel along with this particle coming from M87 galaxy, and even if you were to travel, let's say, 100 million light years, just like they show in this illustration here, I think if you were to kind of add up the distance here, it would probably add up to about 100 million light years or so, until it reaches our own galaxy. If you were to imagine traveling along with this particle at these ridiculous speeds, very, very close to the speed of light, which honestly is very, very difficult to imagine, but the relativistic effects caused by traveling at such high speeds would mean that the particle itself, or I guess you traveling with this particle, would not feel like you traveled for 100 million years. So here we need to actually consider something known as the Lorentz factor. The Lorentz factor, about which you can learn on Wikipedia, refers to the dilation essentially, time dilation or length dilation. And for many of these particles, the dilation effect is roughly around 300 billion. In other words, if you were to become this OMG particle, from the moment you left the region of M87 black hole until you hit planet Earth, for you only about 2.7 hours have passed. So that is kind of mind-blowing. Even though for us here on Earth, it seems like this particle traveled for about 100 million years or so, for the particle itself, it only experienced 2.7 hours of life since its origin, or since the time it got kicked out from the M87 black hole. And honestly, I've personally found this kind of mind-blowing. So obviously, the closer to the speed of light you get, the more dilation you get, and so the slower time passes for you. And so by traveling at these ridiculously high speeds, we could technically explore the rest of the universe. But that's kind of beyond our capabilities right now. And it's sort of beyond the topic of what we're talking about here. So in a nutshell, the scientists behind this paper discovered that it seems many of these high energy particles that we always were wondering about did start around really powerful events like various radio galaxies and then traveled across the universe using these tunnel-like formations known as galactic filaments that are technically some of the biggest structures in the universe. And something caused them to change direction, come closer to planet Earth, and collide with it. And this of course means that we might have finally solved the mystery of the OMG particle and realize that all of them are coming from the same source, but are just getting to us in different ways. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and this right here is Albert Michelson. This was the first American to win a Nobel Prize in Science approximately 100 years ago, and it's also the person that officially stated that there was nothing else to discover in physics. We understood the world perfectly, and there were just some minor things we didn't really get yet. Well, fast forward 100 years and it's mystery after mystery after mystery. And today we're going to talk about another such unusual mystery that has now been maybe clarified just a little bit, but we're going to talk about something we don't really understand, dark energy. Now, it only took a few decades after Michelson's statement for these scientists to realize, well, first of all, that universe was not really how we thought it was to begin with. First of all, back then, people didn't even know galaxies existed. They literally believed that we just lived in one galaxy and everything we saw was part of that galaxy. It wasn't until 1930s that we realized that those little nebulae that we're looking at, they're not nebula. They're actually galaxies far, far, far away from us. And our understanding of the size of the universe since has increased by a huge margin. Now, today we know that the universe also expands. This was something that Edwin Hubble was able to show relatively easily. And we also know that the universe doesn't just expand, it seems to be accelerating its expansion. And this acceleration is really difficult to explain. And for this reason, the scientists proposed the idea of dark energy. Today we think about 73% of everything in the universe is dark energy. with only about 4.6% being composed of things that are common to us, basically atoms. These scientists normally refer to this as baryonic matter. And for the most part, we also think that dark energy amount has changed over time, with some scientists believing that there was maybe no dark matter in the beginning of the universe after the Big Bang. It somehow appeared, or it's something that may have resulted from the interaction with the empty space. In other words, when it comes to mysteries, dark energy is it. It's as mysterious and as not understood as it can get. And so, this is why, when it comes to scientific studies, it's very exciting to see new attempts to try to understand this unusual phenomenon. So this paper right here does just that. They're trying to investigate dark energy, but not by looking at what it is, but instead by looking at what it's probably not. And they do a really good job at establishing what dark energy is not. And by the way, the idea of dark energy and also the idea of dark matter, despite both having dark in them, have nothing to do with each other. They, in a sense, have an almost opposite effect. And really, the only reason we're calling them dark is because we just don't know things about them. While dark matter, we believe, is this unusual force that's responsible for keeping things together and for keeping galaxies from falling apart somehow, the dark energy is this unusual force that seems to be forcing things apart, especially on really large scale distances. So back in the 90s, the scientists discovered that for some unknown reason, the universe was accelerating its expansion the farther away you went. So if we were to look at the universe as it is, let's just say about 12 billion light years away from us, it would be accelerating a lot faster than we initially thought. And these scientists actually won the Nobel Prize back in 2011 for this discovery. But the idea here is that this suggested to us that something was forcing the galaxy apart from each other. And relatively recently, we even came to a conclusion that it's quite possible that the end of the universe is going to be because the universe literally rips itself apart because of the excess of dark energy in it. This is something we're still investigating, but it's sort of hard to imagine. Basically, imagine things being so far apart from each other that the universe just rips. I've made a video about this and you can actually check it out somewhere above my head, but the idea of a big rip is a little bit hard to imagine. So anyway, what exactly did the scientists do in this particular paper? And to begin explaining this, let's remind ourselves that we believe that there are four major forces in the universe. We have the strong nuclear force, we have the electromagnetic force, weak nuclear force, and the gravitational force. Two of these, gravitation and electromagnetism, are quite familiar to us because we experience them in daily lives. The other two are more nuclear and are really, really, really small in scale, so it's something we can't really imagine. But you might remember hearing about them from high school. But some scientists today believe that there is another force, the fifth force, the dark energy force, something that happens when there is nothing around, basically something that happens away from mass, away from galaxies, away from everything, in the middle of empty space of the universe. And so, is this fifth force responsible for expanding the universe? Is this something that we need to investigate and try to understand? Well, this is exactly what the scientists in this paper decided to do. They wanted to see if it's possible for this fifth force to exist. But just a side note, the name fifth force has also been applied to dark matter. So technically we have this fifth force and sixth force that we're investigating. We just haven't found any evidence for this yet. And so this is why we still are stuck with four forces. And the reasoning behind this paper is actually relatively simple. So if it's a force, it's a repelling force that's causing things to fly apart from each other. And so it's very likely that this fifth force would be weakest around objects with less gravity. So here, in the emptiness of space away from this galaxy, the fifth force would be the strongest. Whereas the closer to the central mass we get, the weaker this force gets, with the weakest effects being detected around really massive objects such as, for example, black holes. And so to investigate all of this, all the scientists did was create a vacuum chamber and then put two objects in there. One of them would have more mass than the other. And the object with the least mass was a simple atom of rubidium, while the larger object was some sort of a marble that they were able to move around that was also designed so that it wouldn't really create any disturbances. The overall experiment sort of looked like this, and you can find out more about this in the paper in the description below, but they used several very well-known physical principles to try to see if the larger, more massive object would have less potential dark energy than a much smaller object, which would be the little atom of rubidium-87. And they tried to simulate all of this by taking the marble, moving it around, and seeing if the effects of, well, very tiny effects of dark energy would either increase or decrease the potential repulsion effect of dark energy coming from the atom, and could then be somehow detected. Now, they've used a very well-known technique known as atom interferometry for this, where we essentially use the property of atoms to be able to act like waves or particles. And so by studying the acceleration of atoms caused by the potential dark energy, and by seeing the observed versus predicted results, they were able to establish that, well, there seems to be no effect whatsoever. In other words, the less massive body in this case was not really producing any dark energy and was not causing any more additional repulsion. So basically, no dark energy. It's not a fifth force. Or at least it's not a force that's being formed around the objects with the less gravitational attraction. Because if there was a fifth force in action here, the atoms as they were moving close to the marble would actually veer off the path and produce the observation that would suggest something repulsed them, something moved them away. And this also in a sense disproves several ideas, including the so-called symmetron and chameleon theories that depend on the fifth force being dark energy. And these theories are sort of beyond the scope of this video, but the idea is that they believe that the universe is the way it is because of this unusual force. Now, I'm sure there will be follow-up studies and most likely other discussions on whether this experiment was actually well designed or not, but so far it seems that whatever dark energy is, it's not this innate force of nature. It's not something that's formed in the middle of empty space. It's something else. Maybe a particle, maybe our misunderstanding of how a universe acts and how it's shaped, or maybe something completely different. But going back to the original beginning of this video, despite being the first science Nobel Prize winner in the US, Albert Michelson was way off in his assumption that we knew everything about the universe. It's actually pretty safe to say that we know so little about the universe today compared to what we knew 100 years ago that there are a lot more mysteries out there than there are actual pieces of knowledge we understand for certain. So yes, we do understand simple physics and we know how basic interaction of planets and stars works, but everything beyond our galaxy and also even in our own galaxy is still a huge mystery to us. But this is why this channel is for. We're going to be talking about these mysteries, discussing them and trying to figure them out. Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to talk about one of the experiments that's trying to find dark matter. So dark matter is something that is holding galaxies together, at least we think so, that's one of the explanations. And one of the easiest ways of trying to imagine what dark matter is, or what it might be, is by taking a look at the simulation from Universe Sandbox, where you can visually see how these unusual chunks, the red circles, this is dark matter, are holding the galaxy together. Now, this is kind of relevant to what we're talking about today, because in this model that the Universe Sandbox uses, this is sort of one of the theories explaining or trying to explain what dark matter might be. These are called WIMPs. Weakly interacting massive particles. Now, they're slightly bigger than protons in terms of size, we think. They're also slightly more massive, or a lot more massive, but they don't interact with any matter. And this is why we're calling them weakly interacting, because they don't want to interact with anything, which is why we can't seem to detect them. But they do have a lot of mass, and this is how they're able to hold the galaxies together. Although for the most part, it's still in very sort of hypothetical stages, because once again, we haven't really seen them, we haven't found them, we've been looking and looking and found nothing. And this is of course why there are so many other alternative theories out there, including quantized inertia, that try to explain the universe in alternative means. But nevertheless though, the experiments that have been designed to try to find these things are absolutely fascinating. And today we're going to briefly talk about one of such experiments, because the scientists behind this experiment that's conducted in Italy have discovered something maybe just as incredible and as fascinating as these things right here. And this joint experiment, known as the Zenon experiment, conducted in Italy, is by a team of over 160 scientists from US, Europe, Middle East, basically everywhere, working together trying to essentially find those WIMPs. Now, the way that they're doing it is by using this tremendously large experimentation room that's been placed approximately a kilometer and a half or a mile down in the ground to prevent things like cosmic rays from interfering with this experiment. So they've created this really isolated room, and inside this room they placed a very large container with something like 3 tons of xenon 124. Now, what exactly is that? Well, xenon is of course a noble gas that actually has quite a lot of various isotopes that exist in nature. Some of them are stable and never decay, never change. Some decay really fast and thus produce visible radiation. But for this experiment, they needed to use something that doesn't decay really fast. As a matter of fact, something that almost doesn't decay at all, but can potentially change. And they chose this right here, xenon 124. This element, unofficially, had a very long but somewhat unknown half-life. In other words, we didn't really know how long it takes for it to decay, but we knew that it's super, super, super long. And so we knew that xenon 124 changes into tellurium 124, but we've never observed it, so we didn't really know how long it takes until now. So during this particular experiment, when they placed this xenon underground and they had everything ready, they even had these really powerful electric sensors ready to detect any potential interaction with WIMPs, with dark matter. And well, instead of detecting WIMPs, they actually detected the decay of xenon atoms that they really didn't expect to detect at all. In other words, they've detected something they thought could not possibly happen in human timescales. Here's a simplified version of what the detector looks like. This is where the sensors are, this is xenon itself. And here, any kind of a WIMP that could potentially pass through the xenon container would hopefully produce electrons that could then be detected up here. However, unfortunately for them, but fortunately for everyone else, instead of dark matter, they detected most unexpected event, well, you could almost say in human history, but at least in scientific history, the decay of one of the most stable isotopes in existence. As a matter of fact, the only other element that we know that has an isotope that's even more stable, in other words, an isotope that takes even longer to decay, is an element known as tellurium 128. Now, this here changes into tellurium 124, so an isotope known as tellurium 128 has an even longer lifespan. But how long is long? Well, so for xenon 124, we have now, because of this event, we're able to calculate the half-life of this isotope to be 1.86 billion years. That's 1.8 followed by 20 zeros years. And that's for half of those atoms to turn into tellurium 124. So in other words, for a single atom to change, so in other words, if you were to think about it in terms that are a little bit more clear, this element here is one of the least radioactive isotopes out there. It produces almost no radiation, and it's the first time ever we were able to detect anything coming out of xenon 124, and chances of it happening again are pretty low unless we wait a really, really long time. But why are we even using this particular element? Well, think about it. So we're trying to detect something that's very difficult to detect, and we're using this isotope that's very stable, but still it's an isotope. It can change into something else. So if you were to give it a little bit of a nudge, it would change into tellurium 124, produce some energy that we can hopefully detect using these sensors. However, in order for us not to get distracted by detecting wrong things, we have to place it really deep underground. We also have to isolate it from everything and make sure that no radiation comes in here. Because any kind of an energy or even a slight tremble from a person walking nearby could potentially produce fake results. And so even though they haven't really detected any dark matter, they have now officially were able to calculate the half-life of this really strange isotope known as xenon 124, while, this is actually really important, also establishing the fact that we've now created one of the most accurate detection systems in the world. The fact that we're able to catch those few atoms and then use that to calculate the half-life of a very stable isotope is just mind-blowing. And this is really why the dark matter research is kind of important. Even though these things here might not be real, even though it might seem like we're wasting so much money looking for these potentially imaginary things, what we're using to detect them and what we're creating in the process is super important. We're creating some of the most sensitive, some of the most incredible tools that humans have ever created. And this is why, even though, well, maybe dark matter is not real, just the fact that we're able to create these and potentially use these for some other means in the future, which is actually how a lot of things that we use today have been created. Like, think about things like GPS or things like smartphone use. All of this was not intended for people to use. It was actually either military technology or research technology. So in the future, this particular technology will be definitely used for something else. And this is why it's kind of important. It propels us to discover new things while also creating these absolutely mind-blowing and super technologically advanced rooms that are out of science fiction, but are real. And this is why dark matter research is technically a good thing. Although I guess if one day we discover that dark matter can be explained in some other means, well, it will be heartbreaking for some people, but at the same time, all of this technology will definitely help us in the future. Oh, and before I finish, this is a little bit off topic, but one of the ways I've discovered this particular event is by looking into what the American scientists are working on in terms of trying to find a new way of detecting dark matter. And they're using this really cool phenomenon that went viral on YouTube, because even Veritasium made a video about it, called supercooled water. If you take a bottle of water, and it's a relatively perfect bottle of water with distilled water inside, and you cool it down to, like, let's say minus 10 degrees Celsius, which is below the freezing point, and then give it like a tap or just introduce any kind of an imperfection, this is what happens. It freezes almost instantly. You've probably seen the videos about this. And what's really interesting is that the scientists working on this project decided to create what's known as a snowball chamber. And you can see this is the same effect here, but the principle is a little bit different. You supercool water and you place it in a very airtight and basically everything tight container, protected from absolutely everything. And then you wait for something to cause the supercooling effect, which you can visually observe happening right here. And this is because the scientists working on this project discovered that neutrons passing through this water can actually trigger this. But interestingly, not other things, like for example, gamma rays. So they are thinking that maybe this is actually a much better way of detecting dark matter. And the scientists at University of Albany in New York are currently working on trying to create something that's similar to this, but much larger and with a lot more capabilities of detecting this on bigger scales. So there's definitely a lot of really interesting projects going on right now. A lot of cool new science being created, a lot of cool new devices, and I'm pretty sure that of all of those devices we've created to detect this unusual and possibly non-existent dark matter, at least a few of them will most likely become either super important for us in the future, or potentially might even become something we use daily. Either be a detector of some kind or something else that we've discovered while looking for this elusive dark matter, it will definitely be in your life, maybe in 20, 30, maybe 40 years from now. Assuming, of course, you're still alive. But that's another story for another day. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a discovery of a very unusual bacteria that seems to prefer living in meteorites. And we'll also talk about why this is somewhat important to science. So when it comes to bacteria types, there is quite a lot of diversity on our planet. Essentially, most of the life here are the bacteria. But the bacteria that we're talking about today is this right here. Metallosphaera sidula, as the name implies, has something to do with metals. And more specifically, these unusual bacteria have a tendency to thrive in very toxic to humans environment. More specifically in acidic and extreme environments similar to those found in the Yellowstone National Park. So essentially, it's what's known as an extremophile. And for the most part, they get energy from non-organic matter. from essentially chemicals that humans just can't really use. And just like so many other archaea bacteria or so many other extremophiles, these bacteria were very likely the predominant species on the planet long, long time ago. Essentially, when our planet was barren and had very, very little in terms of the atmosphere or really anything on the surface, these bacteria were probably already creating a lot of stuff in the actual soils. And eventually, through the interaction with soils, some of the early bacteria were able to create layers and layers of various metals and various useful chemicals for other bacteria to take over. We believe today that eventually some of the other bacteria used that leftover material from early bacteria to eventually start producing a lot of methane that we believe may have warmed up our planet. Methane is really the only reasonable explanation for how our planet became warm early on in the solar system. Without methane, we are unfortunately stuck with the so-called early sun paradox. I've talked about this briefly in one of the other videos you can check out on the channel, but in a nutshell, we believe that early on, the sun was actually much, much less active than today. It produced a lot less temperature, and so if Earth was in the same position, it was very likely very cold. And because we know that Earth did have liquid water early on in the creation of the solar system, this can only be explained if the Earth's atmosphere was much thicker or possessed more greenhouse gases like methane and a lot of CO2. So in order to avoid the idea of having a snowball Earth for billions of years, the only explanation we can actually give is that bacteria very likely produced a lot of methane that then converted the atmosphere, making it a little bit warmer. At least that's one of the more prominent theories right now. And so doing research on these unusual bacteria that we still have from basically billions of years ago is exceptionally important for us in order to understand how our planet transformed into something that looks like this. So this is why scientists today want to study a little bit more about these bacteria and also find a way to use them in the future. And it just so happens that we may have found at least one such bacteria that could actually transform both our understanding of how Earth became like this and also possibly where life even came from, but most importantly, be actually usable in the future for mining. So it turns out that the researchers that were investigating this unusual bacteria, when using a meteorite that was found in North Africa a while ago, that you can actually quite easily buy online as well, and then using that particular meteorite's material for growing bacteria in it, discovered something really strange. Bacteria didn't just grow inside this meteorite, it thrived in there. It actually preferred to live in the material from the meteorite known as NWA-1172 than it did in actual rocks here on Earth. And if a bacteria prefers to live in a meteorite than it does in the rock here on Earth, would that actually imply panspermia, or the transfer of life through the meteorites from one object to another? Now, let's not rush into any conclusions, because it really doesn't imply that just yet. There is a very reasonable explanation for why this bacteria does prefer to live, or to actually thrive, in the rock from space rather than a rock from here on Earth. And one of the more obvious explanations here is that the meteorite rock was just a lot richer in various metals and also was a lot more porous. It had a lot more holes in it compared to rock here on Earth. So it was much easier for the bacteria to spread, and it had a lot more resources that it could consume. But nevertheless, this does present a really, really interesting idea of bacteria easily surviving in meteorites while at the same time possibly being able to transfer from planet to planet even in the future. Like, for example, if suddenly there is a meteorite that decides to hit planet Earth and creates a large enough explosion that we're going to simulate right here in a few seconds, that actually creates a lot of debris flying out of the planet, some of those rocks might possess the bacteria I just mentioned. And it also suggests that some of this bacteria might one day basically get to explore space and to travel around the galaxy. Okay, unfortunately it didn't work this first time. Let's try this again with a slightly larger rock. And so here we just want to see the rocks being thrown out of Earth's system. And here we go. There is maybe some parts here that are sort of visible, but they're not actually moving fast enough to escape the Earth's gravity. Unfortunately, this piece will most likely fall back into the planet. But because we have a lot of power here in Universe Sandbox, we can actually change its velocity so it does escape the planet. Let's try this again. And it looks like we succeeded. So here's that rock, potentially with the bacteria present inside of it, that will now be traveling across the galaxy and very likely at some point hit some other planet somewhere else in the galaxy. And this could be how panspermia works. And because we discovered that this bacteria seems to thrive inside meteorites, we don't know for how long, but it does for some time at least, it's possible that this is how various types of life could potentially transfer across galaxy to other star systems. But a much more practical finding from this study is not in regards to panspermia or in regards to where life could have come from. I mean, there's still a lot of speculation here, but we need to do a lot more studies before we can definitely conclude if this ever happened, that life somehow transferred from planet to planet. What we can conclude, however, is that this very strange extremophile bacteria seems to enjoy living inside various asteroids and seems to actually produce materials that we could then use for production of other stuff. In other words, we can literally just take a bunch of the bacteria and find a way to launch it to a nearby asteroid that could potentially have a lot of various metals. And then by putting the bacteria inside the asteroid, we could create an autonomous mining colony, or basically a way for us to mine asteroids without really doing anything. And because this bacteria seems to really enjoy living inside these asteroids, for as long as we find a way for it not to, well, basically die in the cold vacuum of space, we could then turn these large asteroids into very profitable business, kickstarting the next gold rush, as I mentioned in one of the previous videos. Now, the best asteroid for this would of course be this right here. This is known as 16 Psyche, although a much more familiar image that some of you may have seen looks somewhat like this, and NASA is already planning a mission here. This is currently the largest deposit of somewhat unexposed metals and all kinds of minerals and resources that are actually really precious to us here on Earth. In other words, this could be one of the future missions to use this bacteria or some other similar bacteria to create an autonomous and self-sustaining colony that mines all of the materials for us by using the bacteria that seems to really enjoy living there. And obviously there are a lot of other things we need to consider first, such as, for example, whether this bacteria can even survive in other types of meteorites and asteroids by testing this using other samples. But most importantly, we need to find a way to automate all of this process using the modern 3D printing technology, which has already advanced to the point where we could use it in space and create various autonomous stations with it. And so by using this bacteria in combination with various 3D printers, we could then extract and 3D print all of the necessary materials right there on site and then bring them back to Earth. And another important finding from this study is that by looking and seeing what bacteria does to this particular meteorite, we were able to find or to kind of create all kinds of biosignatures. In other words, we can now see what bacteria does to the rock after the material inside the meteorite has been transformed by the bacteria. And so now, if we ever find a meteorite here on the planet, and if for some reason we suspect this meteorite might have life in it, by looking at those biosignatures and comparing them to the ones from this study, we can kind of determine if there was life or if there was nothing in it. And when I just started studying astrobiology, there was actually a lot of talk about this meteorite right here, where there was actually claim for life being found. This came from Mars and was found in 1984 in Antarctica. This is actually what was discovered inside of the meteorite, and one of the major scientists back then, David McKay, proposed that this was actually signs of life. But the professor who I was working under back then actually said the opposite. He suggested that this was just a naturally occurring biomorphic shape that can easily be created by inorganic processes. And the team behind this sort of disproval paper showed that it was totally possible to create something very similar in a typical rock without any life in it. And so in that sense, it's still very interesting to study these meteorites to try to discover where life may have come from, if there was actually life on Mars, and if life did come from Mars, because this is what was implied by this discovery. And so by studying various effects of bacteria on meteorites and trying to compare them to findings from other meteorites will definitely help us answer this question. But because I'm a much more practical person, I also do enjoy the idea or the thought of using this bacteria for turning them into miniature mining colonies. So I'm more excited to hear about studies or actual engineering projects that will take this bacteria and try to find a way to create a mining colony somewhere out there so we can turn our reality into my favorite TV show, The Expanse. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about the so-called dark stars. These stars that are maintained by the presence of dark matter. Now, first of all, I was actually trying to recreate what a dark star might look like, and this is the best that I could come up with, except that it's very likely completely wrong. It just is a very dark star, but it looked nothing like this. If we talk about the idea that I'm going to be presenting today based on several papers. And although there are quite a lot of various dark stars out there, specifically, for example, this right here, this is a brown dwarf, a star that's just dark and doesn't produce enough light, this is not really the type of a dark star we're talking about. We're going to be talking about stars that are dependent on dark matter, and this of course assumes that we believe dark matter exists. So could these so-called dark matter stars exist? Well, at least one scientist out there thinks that yes, they can, or at least they could have, in the early existence of the universe. Specifically, within only a few million years after the Big Bang, when the universe was very, very dense, very hot, and no actual star could exist just yet, this particular scientist, Catherine Fries, whose paper you can find in the description below, believes that these types of stars could have been a reality, and they could also solve a very important mystery of the existence and the creation of the supermassive black holes, whose actual origin is still a mystery. There's at least one paper that came out in 2019 that does try to explain this mathematically, but not everyone agrees with this paper, and it's also very, very vague and trying to help us actually get the grasp on how it may have happened in reality. This paper, however, the one on dark stars, does give us a very interesting scenario on the creation of these beautiful giants. Now, first of all, why is it even a mystery? Why do we not understand how supermassive black holes may have been created? And to answer this is, well, it's basically their mass. Like, for example, this one right here, Sagittarius A star, in the middle of our own galaxy, is about 4.3 million masses of the Sun. And that's a huge, huge giant. It's just kind of difficult to imagine how such a tremendously large object could have formed in 13.8 billion years of the existence of the universe, and even though maybe this one we can kind of explain, some of the larger ones, like the one we all know by now, the M87 black hole, also known as Puleyhi, the existence of this black hole that's basically billions masses of the Sun is very difficult to explain. How was it formed? How can it possibly exist in such a short period of time? And so this is kind of where we come to this unusual idea of dark stars, or dark matter stars if you want to call them that way. Basically, imagine the world as it was only a few million years after the Big Bang. The universe is super, super hot, there's a lot of really dense hot matter, and these stars just cannot possibly form yet, it's just way too hot for them. And so in this particular environment, the dark matter dominates, and it starts kind of combining into chunks and attracting other matter. Now, as it does so, it starts creating these relatively dark objects that soon attract more and more hydrogen and create these very vague, very fuzzy clouds around them that sort of resemble a star but are not as dense as a typical star. Basically, this is a world where you have dark matter in the middle surrounded by hydrogen, we're talking about the really early hydrogen, that creates this very unusual star-like object. And then, because dark matter accumulates, it starts to interact with each other and annihilate each other. Basically, two dark matter particles that we usually refer to as WIMPs, or weakly interacting massive particles, sort of annihilate each other through collision, which of course releases a tremendous amount of energy and allows for the star to exist and to not collapse and destroy itself. In other words, we now have a very interesting structure with dark matter in the middle, surrounded by the star material, surrounded by hydrogen. And this star, because it's generating energy based on the annihilation of dark matter, starts to kind of shine. It starts to produce energy. As a matter of fact, it even becomes visible. Its temperature, according to the paper, is roughly around 9,000 to 10,000 degrees Celsius. So instead of looking like this, like a dark star, it actually starts looking like this. Basically, sort of similar to our own sun. And this is a huge star. It's also very, very bright. It's possibly 10 to even 100 billion times brighter than our own sun. And its size, according to the estimates from this paper, is roughly around 10 astronomical units. Now, just to give you a comparison here, Earth is here, this is the sun, this is one astronomical unit. We now are going to change this into an object that would be a dark star. So once we change its radius, it becomes a tremendously large object that engulfs a lot of objects, a lot of planets, and only I think Saturn is a survivor here, because even Jupiter has fallen into this object. So this tremendously large, very, very bright, and also somewhat massive object does have a tiny amount of dark matter on the inside that's making all of this happen. And essentially what you're looking at is basically just a hydrogen cloud, not very dense hydrogen cloud, with approximately 0.1% of dark matter by mass on the inside that's producing all of this energy. And then we have all of this hydrogen that slowly starts growing in size, creates more and more mass, and eventually might even result in an object that's million masses of the sun. So this could be a tremendously massive dark star, and it will exist just fine. It's actually mathematically totally possible for it to exist relatively untouched by anything for a really long time. But then, of course, something happens. And our universe starts transforming from a very dense, very hot place to a lot more cooler and a lot less dense, and eventually becomes what we have today. Basically, the entire universe is filled with relatively cold space. And as all of this cools down, the star itself starts collapsing, because the dark matter that was within it is no longer able to maintain its reaction and doesn't really produce any more energy. So this whole thing suddenly collapses into basically an ultra massive black hole, or a supermassive black hole, very similar to the one in the middle of the Milky Way, known as Sagittarius A star. But despite this very brilliant explanation, all of this of course depends on the idea of dark matter being real and WIMPs being the major component of this dark matter. In other words, it needs to have these unusual particles that we still haven't discovered that would create this energy. And even though technically it's a very brilliant, very beautiful explanation, there's a very, very high chance we're not going to be able to solve this anytime soon. As a matter of fact, the scientist behind this paper speculates that with James Webb Telescope, we might be able to even see one of these dark stars, but it's very difficult. It's going to be extremely challenging. So what exactly does this involve? Well, first of all, we would need James Webb Telescope to look back in time, to look at the universe as it was billions and billions of years ago, only a few million years after the Big Bang. And if in that particular environment we actually do see something unusual, something really bright, yet something that's not too hot, maybe about 9,000 to 10,000 degrees, in other words, as the scientists refer to it, kind of cool but bright, in that case, we'll know almost for sure that this is probably a dark star we're looking at, and also this is probably a star that's about to become a tremendously massive, supermassive black hole. That will probably then become part of a galaxy somewhere out there. Now, we're still really, really far from seeing these objects, and even with James Webb Telescope, it's going to take a while before we can see this, because if you remember, the Hubble image that we explored in one of the previous videos took several years to produce. Basically, it was a very, 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 very long exposure looking at the same spot for a very long time. So James Webb will have to do the same to try to see the most distant parts of the universe, and to then try to see these unusual dark stars that might be out there. So there's going to be only two possible resolutions. Either we see these strange dark stars and can then conclude that it's very likely that dark matter is probably real, supermassive black holes were probably made from these dark stars, and at the same time Wimps are out there and are responsible for pretty much most of the interaction of dark matter we see today, or we'll see nothing and then we're back to trying to understand our universe from scratch. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a mystery coming from our own galaxy, related to some sort of an unusual energy emanating from a region where we didn't really expect to see anything. And it's also maybe something that will take us closer to answering once and for all, what exactly is this mysterious dark matter? And to begin this, I wanted to show you a picture that was published by NASA, I think about 9 years ago, when we discovered this unusual formation around our galaxy. So if you were to look at our galaxy from this sort of side, or actually this is a much more appropriate orientation, you would see a very strange and very unusual formation right there. So these unusual bubble-like formations are today called Fermi bubbles. We've detected them pretty much completely by accident, but we've known about them for roughly around 9 years now, but we still don't really know what they are. NASA actually has tried to study them very thoroughly and discovered that there's a lot of radiation coming out of them, specifically things like X-rays and more recently gamma rays, and unfortunately there is no good explanation for neither how they were formed, what they are, what's in them, and what's causing this unusual radiation. We just know that they exist and that they are really large and that they're out there. And they're clearly connected to the center of our galaxy somehow, so maybe the supermassive black hole in the middle one day either absorbed some sort of a really massive star that emitted these unusual formations, or maybe the bubbles are somehow related to the astrophysical jets that you see here that were much larger before and then somehow dissipated the material in the formation that we see today. In other words, we don't really know. There's a lot of speculation, there's obviously a lot of attempts to explain these, but we just can't really explain what's happening. And one of the biggest mysteries in regards to these Fermi bubbles came from the Ice Cube neutrino detector that you see right here. This is in Antarctica. That's probably one of the most sophisticated detectors we've ever built. And it's this huge structure, as you can see, it's several kilometers long and is able to detect neutrinos coming from pretty much any direction striking our planet Earth. And very high energy neutrinos were detected coming from this region, which means that there is a lot of really high energy interaction with something. Now, it could be some sort of really fast moving particles, but it also could be something more mysterious. Something we've been looking for quite a while now, the mysterious dark matter. But let's not rush into things and briefly talk about the actual scientific papers. So the first paper that was recently published, and you can see on the screen right here and find it in the description below, literally talks about the detection of a lot of unexplainable gamma rays coming from the Fermi bubbles. So the energy that was created, but we just don't really know what made it. And it's been sort of like that for a long time now. And despite their best efforts to try to explain what's causing them, the scientists behind this paper have no good explanation. We just know that they're there, we just don't know what's causing them. And surprisingly, within a few weeks of that paper, someone else published this, where they actually do look at several unexplainable gamma rays and try to explain them as this mysterious dark matter. And this paper here doesn't actually even talk about the Fermi bubbles, it talks about other galaxies out there. Now, the reasoning behind this here is that in order for us to detect the dark matter, we obviously can't just look at the galaxy because there's a lot of interference here, a lot of other sources of various radiation, so we would have to look basically away from the galaxies, in the so-called galactic halos, or possibly even just in the middle of dark space. And today, most of the dark matter studies focus on three main ways of detecting it. Either by directly trying to create dark matter using the so-called colliders, basically these really large facilities that try to collide particles at really high velocities, or by looking at various effects that dark matter has on regular matter. But then there is a third way, and that's of course related to the particles that might be produced after the interaction with dark matter. In other words, these so-called secondary particles. A good example of a typical secondary particle is when, for example, the cosmic ray comes in from outer space, it starts striking the particles in the upper atmosphere, and the interaction starts producing this cascade of various secondary particles, including things like gamma rays, that we can then detect back on Earth. In other words, the cosmic ray itself is sort of destroyed in the upper atmosphere, and it's the effects of cosmic rays that we feel down here and can even detect using things like Geiger counters. And so very similar secondary particles could actually be created by dark matter as well. And this is exactly what the scientists behind this paper did. They made an assumption that secondary gamma rays could be produced by dark matter, certain types of dark matter. And they started looking around the night skies, or actually no, they basically looked at all data of us looking at the night skies and identified several sources of gamma rays that were either in the middle of nowhere or could not possibly be explained. In other words, they looked at things like halos, galactic halos, or things like just middle of dark space somewhere out there, or regions very close to different dwarf galaxies that are known to have a lot of dark matter, and they tried to identify unexplainable gamma ray phenomena. And having identified pretty much almost 500 various unknown gamma ray phenomena, they then focused on four specific ones that they believed maybe were created by the mysterious dark matter. These four events were just the right type of energy, they also were in just the right position, and could be classified as the so-called light dark matter particle. In other words, they were able to show that certain types of gamma ray emissions could potentially be dark matter. And it just so happens that we have very unusual gamma ray emissions right here, and we can't seem to explain them. But don't get confused, this is not to say that this is definitely dark matter here and that this is what's causing these unusual gamma rays. We still need to investigate these gamma rays in a little bit more detail and compare them to the results from the other paper. But based on what these two papers have discovered and based on what we see right now, there is a slight chance that we might have finally discovered these signs of this mysterious dark matter that we just couldn't find before. In other words, it could have been always here, we were just not looking at the right thing. And what I really hope will happen in the next few months are a lot of follow-up papers that will hopefully explain the type of gamma rays we've detected for coming from our own galaxy, and also maybe connect these gamma rays to the paper that describes them as potential dark matter discovery. In other words, we would really like to find out if this is what we're seeing. Are we actually seeing the dark matter interacting with matter and producing these gamma rays? And if so, great, we finally found it. If not, what's really causing these unusual formations and unusual gamma ray and X-ray emissions from these bubbles? I mean, something has got to be happening there, and we just need to find a way to explain what's going on. Otherwise, we're going to be stuck with even more mysteries to solve and even less theories to try to explain them. But that's, of course, the beauty of modern science, and also why there are so many scientific discoveries pretty much every single day. If you were to look at the amount of papers that come out in this particular field in astrophysics, it is just mind-blowing. And that really makes me hopeful that, well, first of all, gives me a lot to talk about on the channel, but also that we keep looking, we keep trying to find new things. And as a species, we're definitely really eager to discover new ideas and try to find new solutions to old problems. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a new discovery of what might be the so-called fifth force in the universe. So let's start with baby steps. What exactly are the first four forces? Well, two of them you're quite familiar with. First one is gravity, the stuff that keeps you here on Earth, and is basically the force that we can easily see everywhere in the universe. The other one is electromagnetism, which is not just the force inside magnets, but it's also the way we currently generate most of the energy around us. So these two forces are quite obvious and quite familiar to us. But there are two more forces that are difficult to understand because that's the realm of subatomic physics. The so-called strong force is unfortunately invisible to us here in our realm, on our scale, but once you start zooming into the level of particles, you start noticing that things do interact a little bit differently there. And in this particular image, you see the force represented in black. And as you can see, the closer to the atomic scale you get, the stronger the force gets. When it's basically at the level of protons and neutrons, the force is about 140 times stronger than the electromagnetic force. And this is why it's known as the strong force. It's basically the strongest force out there. And to kind of wrap your hand around what it does, it basically holds atoms together. Here in this simple picture, you can see that the protons and the neutrons are held together by something. And this something is the so-called strong force. Without it, the atoms and the subatomic particles would actually just fall apart completely. Which now brings us to force number four, the weak force. This is a little more mysterious and was only officially proven in 1968, but this force kind of explains the so-called atomic decay, or basically how atoms change into other atoms with time. The concept of half-life depends on this force. Here, weak force allows subatomic particles to change their type or their flavor, as it's known in physics. And by letting these quarks change from one type to another, the weak force allows the atoms to then change as well, for example, changing the neutron into proton and allowing for the so-called nuclear decay. When the nuclear decay was originally discovered, the very famous scientist Enrico Fermi, who was also part of the so-called Manhattan Project, responsible for the development of the nuclear bomb, basically proposed that there's gotta be something else going on with the atoms that allows them to decay, and that something was eventually discovered to be this weak force. And so for several decades, it sort of remained to be these four forces, these forces that have been confirmed, we've studied them in a lot of detail, and we know quite a lot about them. But we also always suspected that maybe there is another force. Maybe that force is actually responsible for dark matter and dark energy. Maybe there is something else going on that we can't really explain otherwise. And so the scientists from Hungary back in 2015 decided to actually try to discover something known as dark photons that they believed were responsible for dark matter. And to try to discover this, they were basically bombarding various types of molecules with very energetic light to try to see how those molecules and atoms would react and maybe discover some kind of a secret in the process. For the experiment in 2015, they were essentially using the atoms of helium-4 and turning them into beryllium-8. But while doing so, they discovered something unusual. As they gave those atoms more and more energy, instead of essentially dispersing this energy in a regular way, some of the dispersion was very unusual, as if another particle or another unusual source of energy was actually changing things a little bit. More specifically, the angle that was formed right here was actually not meeting the expectations and the patterns that they were expecting to observe. It looked as if there was another particle that was being extracted from here, a particle whose mass was about 30 times heavier than the electron. And roughly around a year later, another paper came out sort of suggesting that it was actually not a particle at all, that this would be more easily explained if this was a completely new force, the so-called fifth force. And because this article was published in the Nature magazine with its prestige and its reputation to uphold, this was a very big deal. Many scientists tried to actually jump onto this discovery and see if this was correct. And now, only a few weeks ago from when I'm making this video, a new paper from the same team came out with more proof that this so-called X17 particle might be a real thing. They're naming it X17 because of the amount of energy that it has, which is roughly around 17 mega electron volts, which is, as I mentioned before, about 30 times more energy or more mass, the so-called rest mass, than a typical electron. Now, if you're not really familiar with what I'm talking about here, this is the idea that Einstein proposed about 100 years ago, that today we refer to as energy-mass equivalence. In other words, mass is energy, energy is mass. That's kind of how the nuclear reactors work. So this E equals mc squared applies to electrons, and their mass can be defined in terms of the actual electron volts. And if you multiply this by around 30, you'll get the mass of the so-called X17 particle. And this time, instead of using beryllium, they just used helium. And just like before, they once again discovered a similar anomaly, suggesting something was coming out of atoms, something resembling a force, or maybe a new particle. But probably a force. But before anyone jumps into any conclusions here, this is all we know about it. We basically just kind of roughly know the mass of this unusual particle, possibly what's known as a boson, which would be responsible for creating this force. But at the same time, there is absolutely no practical explanation to any of this yet. As a matter of fact, the scientists who studied this in a lot of detail realized that there is currently no physical theory that can explain what's happening. And at the same time, while the scientists behind this paper were actually trying to explain the mysterious dark matter, the signs of which are all over the universe, unfortunately, instead of finding this dark photon, they stumbled upon something completely new and mysterious. And as of today, this discovery has no unexplained physics or any kind of phenomenon that we can actually attribute to it. And it's very likely not an explanation for the mysterious dark matter. As a matter of fact, to try to explain what we're seeing, it's going to take an Einstein-like ability to connect the dots from various studies and various fields to try to understand what's happening, why it's happening, and how this might actually improve our lives later on. If you know the story of Einstein, he was able to actually connect ideas from several different scientists and synthesize physics from very different fields, making them into one clear idea. Something that he was very good at and something that many people admired him for. However, since then, a lot of new ideas have been proposed, and so this synthesis or this idea combination has become a little bit more tricky. It takes a lot of reading to try to figure out what's really happening and how it might relate to real life. However, if this is a discovery of a new fifth force, it's definitely going to redefine our understanding of the world, while at the same time possibly rewriting the physics textbooks if all of this is correct. Now, it will probably take a lot more research and a lot more scientists participating in this to try to either explain this in some other ways or to try to understand what's really happening there and if we've discovered something that's fundamentally different. If this really is the so-called fifth force, we don't really know what it does, why it does it, and how it affects the universe. But this is where things get really interesting, because in the next few years, I'm sure someone will actually be able to explain it. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about an unusual discovery that was just made by scientists after 32 years. There was a star that was missing for 32 years since 1987, we didn't know what happened to it, and we finally found it again. So back in 1987, our understanding of the universe, the space, and the way things work in space changed quite dramatically because of one single event, a very important event. For the first time in modern history, in a nearby galaxy that you can see right here, this is the representation of Large Magellanic Cloud, we've witnessed the first ever actual supernova happening in front of our eyes. This was the so-called 1987 supernova that allowed us to not just see this, of course, but to study it in a lot of detail. The Large Magellanic Cloud where the supernova occurred is only about 160,000 light years away from us, it's right there. And inside of this galaxy, there's actually quite a lot of activity, and so a supernova was sort of expected, but not within our lifetime. And we got really lucky that we were able to observe it in a lot of detail, and it helped us understand and also confirm a lot of theories and a lot of assumptions we had about everything. Things like black holes, things like neutron stars, and of course, a lot of other ideas that today we kind of take for granted. This supernova literally transformed the entire understanding of universe and of cosmos that we had back then. In the image taken by the Hubble telescope, this is what it looked like. It was a very, very bright star that suddenly appeared out of nowhere, although technically there was a star there as well. And this star was a large but also somewhat old blue giant that, first of all, we never actually expected to go supernova, so there's something that surprised us right there. We've learned that blue supergiant stars can create powerful supernova. And following the explosion, it left this beautiful formation that you see on the screen. If we were to zoom in here, as Hubble did for many years and took a picture of this pretty much every year, this is what you'd see. This is over the period of several years, and more specifically over a decade. Here's another way of looking at this and how the actual supernova transformed over time. Now, so okay, this is great, we've learned so much about this, we've seen this, and we've witnessed a supernova in real time, but what exactly is that missing star? Well, following the supernova, we actually could not see any remnants. We've looked pretty much everywhere inside the supernova behind the gas that was left here, and we couldn't see anything. And we expected to find something, possibly an active black hole, possibly a bright neutron star, something. But the thing is, it seems like it just disappeared. And for the past 32 years, scientists have been actively looking inside the supernova, looking through all of this gas in their attempt to basically find this, find the missing star. And we expect all of the nebula that are left by supernova to have some kind of a remnant. Like, for example, this is the Crab Nebula. And if we try to pierce through all of this nebulous clouds, we'll actually find the very famous Crab Pulsar that is essentially a neutron star that was quite thoroughly studied in the last few decades. however not supernova known as SN 1987. Why was there nothing left here? And for the longest time, scientists made a lot of different assumptions. Maybe it turned into a black hole. Maybe all of this gas fell back into the remnant that was there. For example, maybe there was a neutron star, but the gas then made it turn into a black hole that disappeared from the view. Or more exotically, some scientists even thought that maybe it actually became a kind of a different type of an object. Like, for example, an object known as a quark star, which is a hypothetical object that we've never seen, but we do believe it exists theoretically. And a quark star would be an object made out of not typical matter, so not of the actual neutrons, for example, like a neutron star, but out of quarks, the subatomic particles that are even more mysterious than neutrons that pulsars and neutron stars are made out of. So in that sense, a lot of new ideas were formed, and we were trying to explain why nothing was observed. Until today. The paper that was just released a few weeks ago thoroughly investigated the remnant of the supernova and found out at least one area in there where it seemed that something massive and powerful but really small in size was hiding behind all of this dust, sort of resembling what you see on the screen here. That something, according to the scientists, was the missing neutron star. And there is no other explanation for what we're observing, because something in the dust cloud is releasing a lot of energy, something that can only be a massive compact object. And that something could be nothing else but a compact star. Now, we don't really see the star itself just yet, but what we're seeing is essentially a much warmer region of gas that seems to be moved around and heated up by something in the middle. And although technically it could be anything, like for example, maybe it's a very large massive planet or some sort of a star in there as well, the chance of that object being anything but a neutron star is very low. So in that sense, what we're actually observing are the effects of the missing star that we've been looking for the past 32 years. Although technically, even though I keep calling it a star, it's a remnant, it's a neutron star. It's an object that used to be a star, exploded, and now became what's known as a compact remnant. And a typical pulsar or a typical neutron star that this supernova created is usually around maybe 10 or so kilometers in diameter, creating this very powerful, very massive object that's just one step away from becoming a black hole. Now, unfortunately, these rings that you see here, the beautiful formations that were created by the supernova, are not going to stay with us that long. We believe that most of them will probably disappear within the next 10 to maybe 20 years. And even though currently the gas here moves really fast at speeds of about 3000 to 5000 kilometers per second, eventually all of this will transform into a more diffuse cloud that's going to look entirely different and will very likely teach us a little bit more about the evolution of supernova. At the same time, when the supernova occurred, there were a lot of other things we've learned right before it happened. Like for example, today we know that a neutrino burst, or an active burst of neutrinos suddenly appearing and bombarding our planet, is a telltale sign that a supernova is about to be witnessed. And so now we know that whenever we actually see a sudden neutrino burst, something really energetic is about to happen. Also, once the thick cloud surrounding the neutron star disappears in the next 10 to possibly 20 years, we'll finally be able to actually see it and for the first time ever study the neutron star 40 or possibly 50 years after it was created. This is definitely the youngest, closest neutron star to us, and so it's going to be really exciting to see what's really happening right there in the middle. Although hopefully by then we're still able to study the night skies, because with the advent of modern satellites, it's becoming more and more difficult for scientists to see things in, for example, radio waves. Mostly because of the amount of satellites orbiting our planet, which you can sort of see in this simulation, and because of the amount of stuff orbiting, it's becoming more and more difficult to observe and study the night skies. So it's quite possible that by the time that the dust cloud disappears in early 2030s or possibly 2040s, the night skies might be filled with a lot more satellites than there are today. But either way, it's going to be really exciting to find out what we're going to be able to see here in the next 10 or so years as the dust slowly disappears and as the neutron star becomes more and more apparent. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a newly discovered mystery of our partner, the Moon. And in this video, we're actually only talking about what was discovered, because the mystery itself is still a mystery. We're not entirely sure what's happening right there on the Moon. Very recently, I was actually finishing up a video that's going to be released very soon about the largest crater in the solar system as of today. And the crater is somewhere right here. You can't actually see it from Earth because it's on the far side of the moon, but it's actually a lot easier to see in Universe Sandbox because it's shaded slightly differently. It's this huge, huge formation you see right here, roughly around 2,000 kilometers or approximately 1,400 miles across. If you're looking at it from Earth, which would be something like this, you can only really see a tip of it on the bottom right there. You can actually only see some of the mountains formed by the protrusion from the crater. And this huge crater is known as the South Pole Aitken Basin. And what this represents here is a depression within the moon. In other words, it's kind of like a sudden drop in altitude. Now, interestingly, we've studied this crater for quite a long time, and NASA has mapped it quite well. And even right now, there is the famous Chinese mission known as Chang'e 4 that is exploring this area and is trying to figure out what's really happening right there on the surface. And somewhat recently, they have actually discovered that some of the rocks that are in this location are essentially coming from inside the mantle, suggesting that this large collision that created this crater very likely completely upturned the surface of the moon, causing some of the internal mantle to eventually settle on top where it was now found by the Chinese explorers. But the new mystery comes from the data from this project. This is Project Grail that was launched by NASA back in 2011 and actually finished at the end of 2012, where two very interesting craft were orbiting the moon and were mapping its gravitational field. Basically, they were creating the gravitational map of the entire satellite. And they did a really good job at it. And even today, we're still finding new results and new unusual mysteries that we didn't really expect. But most importantly, this particular map was able to explain to us why it's so difficult to orbit the moon with a stable orbit. It's so gravitationally bumpy that it causes most of the craft to eventually lose orbit and collide with the moon. And interestingly, at the end of the mission, NASA even created this very beautiful animation that was created through various shots taken apart, a few seconds apart. And this animation shows moments before these two probes crashed into the moon, which was also part of the scientific experiment. But anyway, so the Grail mission is over, but its data is still being analyzed. And what this data discovered is that deep inside of this crater, there's an unusual gravitational anomaly. Specifically, a really dense, really thick object. Now, okay, before we start going into the aliens here, alien bases or alien explorers, it's not that dense. It's denser than the surrounding areas. In other words, there are two possible explanations. And one of those explanations, which actually is probably the most likely one, is that this is kind of what happened. And so to try to simulate and find out what may have happened, here's an object, it's about 600 kilometers in diameter, and it's going to be colliding with that area of the moon where the crater is located. But the thing about this object is that it's very likely one of the so-called early planetesimals that also on the inside contain a relatively large iron nickel core, or some kind of a more dense core than just rock. And when this object collided, which we're going to try to simulate right now, it literally just kind of shot through the part of the moon. And what's going to happen here is that the iron core is going to go through the upper mantle here, although we don't really see it very well in this particular simulation, and it's going to get lodged inside at a depth of around 300 kilometers beneath the surface of the moon, while the rest of the rocks obviously get deposited on the other side of the moon or just in this vicinity. Now, we know that the actual collision itself very likely took place roughly around 4 billion years ago when the moon was much closer to Earth. So it's very likely that a lot of these rocks also ended up on the surface of Earth. But interestingly, the core itself seems to have been lodged on the inside of this actual crater. Now it's only around 2 times 10 to the power of 18 kilograms in mass, which translates to an object that's about maybe this big. So it's not really that large. That's the leftover core that's now inside of the crater itself, and this is roughly around 100 or so kilometers in diameter. But this piece is now possibly stuck in there. And we know this simply because of the anomalies of gravitational field that we've detected in this area, but at a depth of around 300 kilometers. Now, what this may suggest is that, well, either that sometimes, once in a while, asteroids do actually not completely mix with the rest of the object, like, for example, a planet or a moon, and end up kind of just leaving a huge chunk inside, which may have happened here on Earth as well. Or it may have been that the moon, even back then, was no longer really hot on the inside, and so it couldn't really melt this part, and it couldn't really mix it with the rest of the moon. And so it was left as a kind of a chunk. Now that's one of the explanations. The other explanation is that maybe a type of an oxide was formed somewhere deep inside of this crater, but that was not actually the result of the collision. It was instead a result of the period of the moon when there was literally lava oceans everywhere. And these lava oceans, or in this case magma oceans, may have produced these higher in density materials, these minerals that are now detectable from outside of the moon. And maybe that's what we actually detected underneath. Now, this has to be tested further, but for now, I think the best explanation is definitely that it's basically a chunk, a core of an asteroid, a large asteroid that collided with the moon and left a piece of itself lodged inside of our satellite. Now, this creates a lot of questions, of course, but also creates an opportunity for us to maybe one day, hopefully, drill deep enough into the moon's surface to actually reach and study and maybe even mine this, whatever this is. For all we know, it could be some really cool metals that we don't have on Earth, or some cool metals that are very precious on Earth. So moon actually might be now a potential target for mining. Although maybe that's not the best thing to do with the moon, but still, it's something that could maybe give it a bit of a more financial reason to go and settle, even though this core is technically kind of tiny. Now, further studies will definitely explore this idea even more. Unfortunately, unless we really drill something like 16 to 18 kilometers deep down, we're not going to be able to collect any samples, but we can potentially analyze all of this using the data from the GRAIL mission that I showed you previously. So future scans of the moon, along with future explorations of the moon, might help us discover what's really happening in this unusual biggest crater in the solar system. This crater right here that I've just recreated using Universe Sandbox, almost identical to the original crater in size. So anyway, on that note, once we discover what's hiding beneath the surface of this crater, I'm going to come back and talk about it again, but for now, that's all we know. It's a mystery, but it's a very interesting scientific mystery, not really a conspiracy. Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video, we're going to be talking about new research and a new paper that seems to suggest that basically everything in the universe is connected, literally connected through a very unusual, but currently somewhat invisible filament. So when it comes to stars and constellations and, of course, galaxies, we do know that many of them are somewhat connected to each other gravitationally. Like, for example, if we were to find one of the typical globular clusters here in the Milky Way galaxy, we would find ourselves in something that looks like this. And this is basically a gravitationally connected structure where all of the stars and all of the neutron stars and black holes and everything in the middle here is connected and moves together and never really separates from one another. These are pretty much everywhere around the universe, and we've seen quite a lot of them in our own galaxy. But on much larger scales, we obviously get other gravitationally connected objects, and I guess the most famous one would be this, the galaxy. But it obviously does not stop there, because we've in the last few decades discovered that even galaxies connect to other galaxies. More specifically, the Milky Way, for example, connects to its satellites and to some extent to the Andromeda as well. So basically, the Andromeda galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, and all of the nearby satellites like the Large Magellanic Cloud, the Small Magellanic Cloud, or even this right here, the Diffuse Sagittarius Spherical Galaxy, all of them are connected to the Milky Way through these somewhat invisible, but nevertheless present gravitational links, and in most cases, we even have actual signs of those links being formed. And you may have seen one of my previous videos about the Magellanic Bridge and the Magellanic Stream. Both of these are actually separate connections between various galaxies. So this right here is a connection between the Large Magellanic Cloud and the Small Magellanic Cloud, which are these two largest satellites of the Milky Way. This right here is the Large, and right there in the corner, right here, is the Small Magellanic Cloud. And they do have a connection, and we've seen it several times now. And also, these two galaxies have an actual gas connection to our own galaxy, which unfortunately is not shown here. So in the video that I made a few months ago, I did explain how all of this has been found and how we now know that this connection is actually physical. There are even stars between these galaxies that are formed in this gas. But then, as you start looking at the larger scales, you get something known as the local group. The local group of nearby galaxies looks something like this in three dimensions, and the Milky Way is right there, this tiny spot in the middle, with these satellites being here, and the Andromeda and the Triangulum galaxies being right here. All of them also have their own satellites. This is also gravitationally connected, and we have actually found links, physical links, that connects them as well. Now, today most scientists believe that all of this is sort of propagated through the mysterious dark matter. And there are quite a lot of various evidence that suggest that this is actually true. But it doesn't end here. If you were to zoom out of here even more, you would discover an even larger gravitational connection, forming first a cluster and then a supercluster. This supercluster that we are in is known as the Virgo supercluster. It's actually this right here, and you notice that there's this yellow formation. That's the largest gravitational structure we've discovered to date, and it currently has a name. It's known as Laniakea. The Laniakea supercluster is essentially the extremely large gravitational structure that has been reported by using this image right here, and I've also made a video about this explaining what exactly this shows in the past. But the idea here is that, so this is literally an actual structure, it's a physical connection between galaxies, but it also does not stop there. As we just discovered, especially in the recent paper that came out only a few weeks ago, there seem to be even more mysterious connections out there. Something that scientists currently have no idea how to explain, but they do seem to suggest that the connections are even more profound than we previously thought. And in this particular paper coming out of South Korea, what the scientists discovered is that when they looked at the galaxies nearby and compared them to the galaxies that are actually much farther away, specifically roughly around 20 to 30 million light years away from the Milky Way, which would be equivalent to maybe this distance right here, so the galaxies at this distance, all seem to also have a very unusual connection that was detected in a very unusual way. So when the scientists behind this paper looked at essentially properties of galaxies, they noticed that many of those galaxies were actually moving and spinning in a very similar pattern. So when they looked at certain galaxies in one direction, they noticed that those galaxies had exactly the same spin and were, for example, moving away from us. Then they looked at other galaxies in a different direction and saw the opposite effect. Those galaxies were moving away from us and also spinning in a different direction as well. And their spins and their motion was actually correlated, as if something was mysteriously causing them to move and rotate in a very similar fashion, even though they were really, really, really far away from one another. So at this distance here, there was some sort of a mysterious force causing these galaxies to behave in a very similar way, and it can't be just explained by galactic gravitational forces. It has to be something else. And one of the suggestions and one of the explanations so far is that it definitely has to relate to something known as the galactic filaments. The video about the filaments should be popping up somewhere right there, but essentially, in a nutshell, what this refers to are these formations that you see right here. This is from the beautiful Illustrious Project, which created one of the most realistic, if not the most realistic, simulations of a universe. And this simulation of the universe shows us that there have to be these very unusual formations, these filaments, that are formed by the combination of this blue stuff that you see here, this is the dark matter, mixed with the actual gas that forms stars and obviously other objects as well. And at the same time, all of this is then joined in with the actual galaxies that you see right there. They're barely visible. So all of these galaxies are connected with the gas and dark matter filament. Here's what this image looks like if you were to add all of the gas, and here's what all of this image looks like if you were to add the dark matter. So all of this is not as visible as actual stars because, you know, stars are producing light that we can easily see from really far away, but neither gas nor dark matter produce much. And so we only know, or we only suspect their existence simply by observing the effects. And one of these effects is, of course, this unusual observation that the galaxies seem to have some kind of a strange relationship and connection that causes them to act differently. And in a nutshell, the scientists behind this paper do suggest that there's this unexplained phenomenon that's causing these galaxies to behave in a very similar way. You can find out more about this by reading the paper in the description below. And the thing is, this is not the only thing the scientists have seen in the past few years. We also observed several other things, like, for example, there is an unusual alignment of quasars, or these really, really bright galaxies, across an even larger distance. We're talking about billions of light years. This is like thousands of more times far away than what we've just looked at. And this was reported by the scientists from Belgium about 5 years ago, and the paper for this you can also find in the description below. But here what they discovered is that even on these larger scales, the actual quasars seem to have a very unusual and somewhat predictable alignment, suggesting that these unusual filaments, or whatever it is, causes the actual galaxies to kind of align, to have a very specific direction and rotation compared to other galaxies at really, really, really far away distances. There's almost no way that this happened by chance. It's almost impossible because of the amount of galaxies that they're studied, and also simply because this was a three-dimensional observation in every direction. This wasn't just in one single direction or in a single part of the universe. This was literally by looking this way and then looking that way and seeing a very similar repetitive pattern. Now, all in all of this kind of suggests one single thing. The entire universe is connected gravitationally and linked through these unusual formations about which we unfortunately know very little. And one of the reasons we actually do need to study dark matter in a little bit more detail and find out what exactly is happening with it, what it's made out of, and what it does to the universe is because it literally seems to have this effect on the entire universe. It controls the actual galaxies, it controls everything in the universe, and by being able to control dark matter, or at least in some way manipulate it, we might be able to find a way to control the universe. And to quote one of the characters from Frank Herbert the Dune, "He who controls the spice controls the universe," replacing the spice with the dark matter. So it's something that we need to understand if we want to one day become an interstellar and an intergalactic species. Maybe we'll succeed, maybe not. But until we discover something else about this unusual phenomenon and about these unusual effects that we're observing across millions and even billions of light years, that's really it. The objects known as neutron stars, also known as magnetars or pulsars, are absolutely fascinating. They're teaching us a lot about the universe, and I've talked about them many, many times on the channel. This one right here that I'm slowly going to try to approach is one of the most well-known. This is the so-called Crab Pulsar, and it's surrounded by the so-called Crab Nebula. And here it is. One of the other well-known pulsars with a name is known as the Vela Pulsar, and it's actually one of the most well-studied objects out there in the universe. I've honestly been trying to detect it myself for a very long time. I've even tried building amateur radio antenna, but unfortunately it was just not powerful enough. But it is a very interesting hobby that some people have, and there are quite a lot of amateur astronomers out there that have been successful at detecting Vela Pulsar and seeing its pulsations. And because each pulsar we've discovered is so exceptional and so unique, and also is quite stable in its pulsations, we've even thought of using pulsars as a kind of a permanent marker, or literally a lighthouse to try to navigate the galaxy when we're able in the future. So it's very likely we're going to be using pulsars such as this one right here to navigate the universe. Now, that's of course in the future. For now, we're going to be talking about just neutron stars in general. When it comes to neutron stars, or really any other objects that are known as collapsars, they're essentially created in a very similar way. If a star is very massive, more massive than our sun, it's going to have a really powerful supernova, which will then end in either a neutron star, or if the star is even more massive, then a black black hole. Whereas if a star is less massive, like for example a star similar to our sun, it will eventually release the outer shell as a planetary nebula, there's going to be no supernova, and it's going to end up as a white dwarf. All three objects are really, really dense, but the white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black holes are exceptionally different from each other. So here's an example of a white dwarf, this is Sirius B, the closest one to us, compared to our planet Earth. Their size is similar, but the mass here is closer to the mass of our own sun. Then, if you were to compare this to a neutron star, the mass doesn't change much, but the size does. Pulsars are really small, they're roughly around 10 to maybe 20 kilometers in radius. And that means that the density here is much, much higher. And this density creates a lot of really, really extreme effects, specifically relativistic effects. What's interesting is if you were to actually stand on the surface of a pulsar, which we can't really simulate really well in Universe Sandbox, you would be able to see more than half the surface of a pulsar. Here's roughly what this surface would look like. This is just an image showing you that if you were to stand in the middle, you would be able to see, due to the relativistic effects, sides of the pulsar that would be invisible otherwise. In other words, you're seeing a much larger surface around you. But don't forget, this is not really a place where you want to find yourself. The gravity here is so high that you would be squeezed into an atomic scale object. And if you were to free fall into a pulsar, you would very likely collide with close to the speed of light, producing a tremendous amount of energy. At the same time, these objects usually spin very fast, which creates very powerful centrifugal forces that would very likely stretch you into a spaghetti and basically destroy you in every other possible way. So what I'm trying to say is that you don't want to be here. Nevertheless though, these objects are fascinating, and just like the white dwarfs, they do seem to have a mass limit. And for white dwarfs, this mass limit is known as Chandrasekhar limit. If a white dwarf reaches a mass of roughly around 1.4 masses of the sun, which we can simulate in Universe Sandbox, the object goes supernova. And a very similar situation occurs with neutron stars, but their mass limit is known as a much more complicated word. In short, it's known as the TOV limit. And this limit refers to the idea that at some point a neutron star will just be very unstable and will very likely collapse into a black hole. Now, we believe today that maybe some of the pulsars can spin fast enough to prevent this from happening, but at the same time, this limit has been long believed to be around 2 masses of the sun. In other words, we haven't really been able to find any neutron star that was more massive than that, until now. And so the scientists behind this paper, that you can find in the description below, did a very, very interesting analysis of a neutron star we discovered back in 2012. The neutron star they discovered has a partner, and the partner is a white dwarf. And this white dwarf passes right in front of the neutron star, so we can actually see their interaction and measure it in a lot of detail. And the way they did this was quite brilliant, although this is not the first time it's been done. By measuring the radio waves coming from pulsar as the white dwarf passes in front of it, they were able to detect slight minute changes in the white dwarf. In other words, as the white dwarf passes in front of a much smaller neutron star that's somewhere right there, it influences the emissions because it also has quite a lot of density and quite a lot of mass. And so the radio waves, as they pass through the white dwarf, kind of decrease in speed a little bit because they get to travel through this distorted space-time that slows them down, and we can actually see this. And by using this distortion, we can calculate the mass of the white dwarf. And once we know the mass of the white dwarf, and by knowing the orbital period, which is roughly around 4.77 days, we can then very accurately estimate the mass of the pulsar as well. And by using this technique known as the Shapiro delay, they were able to find that this here has a mass of about 2.14 to maybe even 2.24 masses of the sun. In other words, it's way more than we thought it was possible. We actually didn't think it would be possible for a neutron star to have a mass more than 2. Here, it's about 2.14 or maybe even more masses of the Sun. And because all of this happened at a distance of about 4,600 light years away from us, it's actually kind of impressive that they were able to do it so precisely and were able to actually see all of this in a lot of detail. But this is, I guess, where the mystery begins, because we don't really know how this star is able to maintain itself and how it's possible for such a massive star to exist and not to become a black hole. In other words, we're back to kind of scratching our heads, trying to figure out what exactly is happening here. Now, it's very funny because back in the days when we just discovered the neutron stars, back then we actually believed and thought that these are alien signals. Because of the irregularity of radio transmissions, many scientists were absolutely amazed at how it's very likely the first discovery of alien life. Today we know that these are very, very unique objects that produce these very unique emissions, but we still don't really know much about them and we still don't really understand what goes on inside of them, specifically because there is just a lot of really strange and weird things happening not just on the surface of the neutron stars, but also inside of them. And this is something we'll probably never really be able to understand until we're able to create something similar here on planet Earth or simulate it using some kind of a super, super ultra fast computer. But for now, that's all I wanted to mention in this video, and really that's kind of all we know. We know that this is a really massive neutron star that doesn't really make sense. We know that there are going to be a lot of follow-up studies trying to discover what's happening here, but we also know that this is just a new mystery we need to solve. And by the way, if you've ever wondered who actually discovered the first neutron star, it was this wonderful lady right here, Jocelyn Bell from Ireland. And she's still alive and well and has recently been awarded a very prestigious prize for her discovery, basically several decades ago. But we'll talk about her in some of the future videos because she's a great woman and deserves a separate video. And anyway, on that note, that's all I wanted to mention in this video. Come back tomorrow to learn something you may have not known before and maybe even support this channel on Patreon because it does help me quite a lot. I'll see you tomorrow. Space out, and as always, bye-bye.